of order. We have any adjustments to the agenda? Other than principal?
No, oh, sorry, no. Hard to hear you over the thunderous rain.
Yeah.
I know.
Try and do something.
It's not leaking. Yeah, it's not leaking, and I approve that it is raining hard outside. We have no communications, bill schedules are circulating.
Yeah.
Need to be signatures, and before we interview the two candidates, for, you get the first one.
You get it?
Yep. I'll take a motion to approve the minutes of May 3rd. Regular school meeting.
So moved.
So motion by Suzanne, second by Ginny. Is there any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, abstained? It's unanimous. So tonight we are here to interview or meet the two finalists for the Pembroke High School principalship. We have two candidates, Joshua Frank and Mark Talbot. I'm assuming Joshua is first. So he will come here, we're putting a half hour on each of the candidates for questions. I'll try to make sure they speak up, I'll speak up. If you have trouble hearing them, please just raise your hand and I'll ask them to speak up.
Thank you.
I'll try to look over.
We'll just go like this.
I'll be able to pick that part up, sure. Yeah, just let us know and make sure, because we know from the superintendent interviews, sometimes it's tough to hear over there. We don't know because we're hearing fine, so once you hear, good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome. So, Josh, my name is Mike Tropiano, chairman of the school committee, along with Paul Bosworth, Sue Scroggins, and Ginny Wendell. We're happy you could make it here and beat the rain.
Just
in the nick of time. So, you have a half hour allocated.
Mm-hmm.
What we were hope is, why don't you talk a little bit about yourself, what makes you interested in Pembroke. We'll have some questions for you.
Okay.
And we'd like some out of that 30 minutes to reserve a few minutes for you to ask us questions.
Okay.
So you can understand what it's like. You know, obviously you've met Aaron and a lot of other parents and folks within the district. We want to make sure that you have the opportunity to ask us and understand what our interests are and where we're headed. We feel we're headed strategically.
I appreciate that.
Thank you.
So, having me. I'll start off by telling you a little bit about who I am and my experiences. I was great to Pembroke. I have been an educator for 27 years. I've arrived.
That's a sign from above. That's a sign from above.
Boy, that really worked well. Anyway, as I said, I've been an educator for 27 years, 16 years as a classroom teacher. 9 of those years I've worked at the high school level, 4 years as a teacher, and 5 years as an administrator. I have been a principal of middle school, and for the last 5 years I've been an assistant headmaster at Randolph High School. I am married, I have 2 children, 24 and 21, and neither of them has moved home back home yet.
Yes,
well, my application is now. For the past 5 years at Randolph High School, we have successfully raised our graduation rate from 69% to 85%. We have done that under 3 superintendents and 2 principals in 5 years. My work has been primarily supervision and evaluation of teachers. And so I think together the teachers and I are very, very proud of what we've been able to accomplish. Our graduation was Sunday, and we graduated 85% again. And I calculated the number in the cafeteria. If it were 69%, that would be 31 students who had not graduated. Having said all of that, one of the reasons I'm here, and one of the reasons I'm very interested in Pembroke, I'll start with the positive part. From what I can see, this is a very close-knit community where people work together, where they value education, and they value the community. And people speak with, I think, what I can tell, a pretty clear adult voice. Again, in Randolph, this is the negative part. There has been a lot of turnover, and it's difficult to sustain our gains in that circumstance. As I mentioned earlier, I was a principal in Wellesley, at Wellesley Middle School. There, achievement was already very high, and during my tenure there, we drastically reduced reports of bullying. That improvement has really sustained itself since I left. I think one of the things that I bring is an ability to make improvements that sustain themselves, because they're not about me as the principal, they're about the process, they're about the team. That's who I am. In terms of the other piece about Pembroke, one of the things that I've been working at in Randolph, especially over the last couple of years, is really increasing the level of rigor. We do have about 80% of our students in Randolph High School who go on to higher education, but not necessarily at the same level of school that your children might be applying to here. I would welcome the opportunity to really work with people on increasing rigor in a way that really works for the 21st century and really works for high school students who are on their way to college. College is, in some ways, is changing very, very quickly right now. And it's really important that that students, even in a community that's very close-knit, are exposed to other ideas, more of a global perspective. That's work that I've done in Randolph that I feel like I could bring here in a way that would work well for the faculty and parents here.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Let me start with kind of go around the table and start with Jenny.
Well, rather than picking some brand new topic, just wrote a few questions to ask a little bit more deeply. Can you just talk about your methodology? So certainly you say the word bullying, and we've gone through policies of defining bullying, and we've been staying close with this topic for at least, dare I say, 5 to 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Different programs, who can bring what, at what level, is it in the school building, how do we reach the community, what about school buses, blah, blah, blah. How can you help us define identifying that bullying behavior? And you said you had marked improvement in the fact that there were reduced reportings.
Yes, there
how
were.
How do you qualify that?
Well, I brought some numbers. I'm basing this... these are documents that I shared with Aaron and Mary Beth, so I thought I'd just bring copies for everybody.
This is not a setup. I just was curious.
Yeah.
So, good for you.
I've never met you before. In terms of the data that I'm basing my claim on, it's from the Metro West Adolescent Health Survey. And it is administered every 2 years. Brought numbers. I also brought the graduation numbers, the MCAS numbers from Randolph, in a diagram for how I work with teachers, and I'll pass this out later. But what this shows is that the reports of bullying in the building declined fairly dramatically, fairly quickly. I don't have a single program, and honestly, I think sometimes the problem is we want to buy a program.
Yeah.
What we did when I got there, I had a group of teachers come in and say, we have a terrible bullying problem. And the problem is that when kids bully, they're not punished. There's not a consequence. And so we want an escalating series of consequences, and that will take care of the problem. That's not the direction I wanted to go in. Punishment is sometimes necessary to stop behavior, but it doesn't teach. A part of what I would talk to this community about is confronting children with the fact that they've hurt somebody. That's what bullying is. Because if you remember being a teenager, it's pretty easy to not think about things that you don't want to think about. and given the social pressures of middle school and high school, you know, behavior like that, if it's not named and confronted, it can really escalate pretty quickly, it can become very serious. So what we did is we started by naming what bullying was, which was hurtful behavior. We developed a hurtful behavior form, which triggered a series of conversations between targets, between aggressors, and guidance counselors and school administrators about what had happened. It also came with a labeling of that behavior as bullying if it were to happen again, at which point consequences would kick in. The other thing that we did is we got children very, very involved in this. We started a club called the, I'm sorry, blanking on the name here, the Safe Schools Club. Messed up the name there, but that was the basic idea, Students for Safe Schools. And a part of it was a middle school version of the Gay Straight Alliance. And they worked with a group of very enthusiastic and empowered teachers, and they took it from there. And that club really became a very positive and very visible force in the school. And it became really uncool, to put it. And it really, the last I heard, which was a couple of years ago, they're still using hurtful behavior. So I think it's really how a lot of it is how you set up the conversation. Embedded in all of that is also a very clear expectation that when you have behavior like that, it's going to be confronted. It's going to be confronted honestly. And it's going to be confronted firmly, but not just with the idea of, we'll punish you, so you stop this. So that's how we approached it.
Can I just ask you quickly, two things. The grades were in middle school?
6th grade.
And the parent piece that I'm guessing, was there a parent piece in there?
There was, yes. We ran a few workshops for parents on our program. We had guest speakers from the high school student group. We also had a guest speaker who talked about suicide prevention and the connection to bullying prevention. And parents were involved in all of that. A lot of the bullying work was embedded in a fairly elaborate survey we did, which was organized around the question, does your child feel bullied or done at Russell Middle School? We had about 350 responses, and then we did a workshop with parents to look at the good news and look at where we felt like we needed to do some more work. So that's one of the ways to involve them as well. I'll call on somebody else.
Talking about succession, so if your responsibility and was in the middle school and you continued to keep tabs, so to speak, even now, because you're curious, because that's an admirable thing. Where was there a piece to this at the elementary level, at primary level, and how did it follow through? Was there follow through to the high school?
There wasn't any outreach to the elementary school level. There might have been since then. We were very involved with a group at the high school that came down and brought student speakers with them. And we share our work with the principal of the high school. I haven't looked at their numbers, but generally speaking, they started to come down in high school as well. Most of the outreach we did was in working with this group of students. It was about 15 or 20, there were a couple of faculty who sponsored them as well. I'm not remembering the name of the group, but mostly the work was in middle school.
I'll pick up on the communication piece a little bit. Outside of the specific instances in terms of bullying and the social economic, social emotional issues that Jimmy was talking about, how might you, being new to the community, connect with and communicate with the parents in the community? As you said earlier, we are with a lot of, it doesn't show by our audience, but we have five extremely passionate people there. And there's a lot more, but how might you communicate and connect as a new person in this community with parents?
Well, a few things I do right off the bat. One is I would try to coordinate with the current principal to see if I could send out a letter to parents at the end of this school year, maybe to go with report cards. I would also reach out to the community to invite parents to come in and meet with me during the summer. You know, really, a lot of that would be about doing a lot of listening, what people see as areas of strength, what are the challenges they see, what, you know, what's one thing they've been hoping to change forever, and now's their big chance, you know, that kind of thing. But I'd set up some open hours during the summer. And assuming that that might not be enough to get a lot of people in, I would also ask the superintendent, where are some community events during the summer where I can attend? And introduce myself to people, shake some hands, say hello, you know, whether it's athletic events, whatever it is, just so I can get out there and meet people face to face. And I did meet a member of the PTO, Deborah, over there. I'd probably reach out to her and see if there were some people that I could reach out to by phone and say, well, I'd like to have you come in and talk. And so that's how I would start. I would, through the course of every school year, do monthly workshops with parents. And on various topics, you know, it might be bullying, preparing, you know, the new SAT, dealing with diversity in college campuses, a million things to talk about, developing a growth mindset. And in part, those would be about education for parents. You know, I've been an educator for a long time, but more than that, they'd be about our getting to know each other and learning about each other and really doing the work of educating and raising your children together. So I would do those every month, and that would be another way. And I don't know if you do this now, but there's a monthly newsletter from the principal. I send one of those out. I, in Wellesley, as principal, encouraged a lot of back and forth with parents by email. And, it was actually a lot of fun. We communicated quite a bit by email. You know, one of the things I learned there is the importance of real transparency. And, you know, things happen. We had a couple of bomb scares when I want to say my first year. So there's a lot of communication with parents around that. This is what's happened. This is what we're doing next. This is how we're working with the police. And yes, this is how we found the person responsible. And this is what's going to happen next. So just that kind of communication, I think, builds a lot of relationship very quickly. People want to know that you're going to communicate with them, and that you're not hiding things.
Sure. You talked a little bit about the college process.
Yes.
And the expectations there. Could you talk some about your vision for a guidance department? What do you envision in 3 years, if you were to get this role, how would you like the guidance department to be described? Mm-hmm. As well as talk maybe about some of the things you've done with other guidance departments in your previous roles.
My vision for the guidance, you have 4.5 guidance counselors?
Four and a director.
Four and a director, okay. My ultimate vision would be that guidance counselors follow their students all the way through the 4 years, so there's a 4-year relationship. There are trade-offs to doing that, especially when you're writing recommendations to seniors. But I do like the idea of having a guidance counselor really have 4 years to get to know a child. I would want guidance counselors to be very, very well trained in understanding how to address social and emotional issues, and I'd want them to have a strong voice at the table with me and the rest of the administrative team and social workers and counselors and whoever else to help us support kids with social and emotional issues. I would want to make sure that every child by the middle of their junior year was registered for the SAT and or the ACT. And I would want to make sure that every guidance counselor knew the strengths and challenges of each of their students. I would want the guidance counselor to, guidance department to bring in a lot of resources. And by resources, I mean visits from colleges, but also college students who come in and talk about what it's like to be a college. And I think more than anything else, And you may be doing some of this now, and if you are, I would like to build on it. But I'd really like to see a success analysis plan that reaches out to graduates who are 1, 2, 3, and 4 years out from graduating from Pembroke High. To really work with them on in what ways did we prepare you well and what ways did you feel not so well prepared so that we can improve what we're doing. I think it's invaluable to hear from students who have left and are out in the world, and or at least on college campuses, and hear from them. What worked well for you? What was challenging? What did you not feel so well prepared for? What do you wish your guidance counselor had done if they didn't think to do? Those kinds of questions. So I'd want to see that institute as well. Again, if that's something you're not doing, you would want to work with the guidance department to start something like that. And if they are doing it, I'd like to make sure that it increases.
I did. The town just allocated resources for a school resource officer to be split between the middle and high school. So, anticipating you probably have a police officer in the building for the first time in the school's history for 50% of his or her time. What role do you feel this resource officer would have in the building? How would you work with them to establish what the protocols, guidelines are, and how would you use them as a resource to help within student engagement?
Well, I think one of the first things that I would do with a school resource officer is work with them on understanding the importance of building relationships with all students. It is really important for a number of reasons that a school resource officer not just be seen as the person you go to when somebody has done something wrong and is going to be in trouble. One very practical reason for that is students, if they have a relationship with a school resource officer, bring a lot of important intelligence about what's actually happening in school, what's happening outside of school. And you want to make sure that the school resource officer has that cover, if you will, I talk to these kids all the time. And I think that it's really important for a school resource officer to have an education role. I would want to work with a school resource officer on drug and alcohol awareness, on teen dating, on dating violence. There's a million things that there's a fine line between education and safety and law enforcement. And being inside the school, that person has an opportunity to do a lot of education. Now, obviously, if I were to be the new principal, I've got my own vision of how what that work should look like. But a new school resource officer is going to bring their own style, their own vision. And part of my job would be to work with this person, get a sense of what they feel like their strengths are, what they're excited about. You know, it's hard to create a new position. If there's a structure built in, you step in. Part of this is going to be about building a structure and what's that going to look like. So we would want to work with that person in that. So.
So we have a few minutes. We have about 5 to 7 minutes. So if you could ask any quick follow-up questions, things like that.
Just quick time.
Mm-hmm.
Just a couple of maybe 1, 2, 3 examples of what you feel are must-do behaviors for you to communicate with your teaching staff, best practices, or how you want to engage to get that rapport with your teaching staff.
Yes, 1, 2, 3. Number one, student engagement, and that's through the building of positive, appropriate relationships. Number two,
you can hear it over the fingers.
There's been no more thunder since that. Student engagement.
Yep.
And building strong relationships with students, greeting them at the door, getting to know who they are, what they like to do, praising their wardrobe, whatever it is to build that relationship. But in the service of engagement, in the service of getting kids interested, that's number one. Number two is a high level of rigor. And rigor looks like there are a lot of different ways to measure both engagement and rigor. But if kids are happy in a classroom and they're having a good time, they're not learning anything. That's, you're not doing well. I do a lot of work with teachers in Bloom's taxonomy and on making sure that there's clear, accountable assessments for students every day. And number three is student voice. There have to be opportunities for students to speak, to discuss, to disagree, to make mistakes, to articulate their thinking. And teachers have an obligation to facilitate that in as skillful a way as possible. And those are the three must-dos. And that's where the accountability is. The flip side of that accountability is that I provide a lot of support for teachers who may struggle in one of those areas or another. How do you do this? How do you make sure that there's a high level of rigor? Just putting analyze on the board doesn't do it if you don't have the follow-through. But those would be the three things.
Engaging the teaching community was my question, too. Mm-hmm.
Engaging the teaching community?
Well, you yes. talked about mm-hmm. how you, yeah.
So speaking of engagement.
Yes.
So you've got a population of schools very involved in athletics, very involved in music, arts. How do you get to or engage the kids who aren't involved in some of those activities?
Who are not involved in music, arts, athletics?
Yeah. Can I just sure. follow up on that? Mm-hmm. Sort of to Jeannie's question at the beginning. How do you engage those kids? Because on the survey, it's self-identifying for your bullying, mm-hmm. and a lot of the times we look at the bullying stats of kids who self-identify who come with a problem. Mm-hmm. How do you get to that student so that they're engaged in the school so that if there is a problem, we know about it? Because my concern on the bullying mm-hmm. is the non-reported items that we don't know about that you find out years later.
Mm-hmm.
So if you could tie that with that,
mm-hmm. thanks. Sure. Well, to start with the second question, that's why I start, number one, is building relationships with students. There's a lot of research that says that when students feel a connection with an adult at school, they do a whole lot better, they tend to report things. Hopefully they have more than one adult they feel comfortable going to. But it's really the job of the teachers to build those relationships so that if something's going on, a child feels comfortable coming to them. In terms of reaching out to those other kids, I mentioned student voice, and one of the things that I would want to think about is looking at the extracurriculars that we do have and looking at reaching out to students whose interests are not represented by what we have in terms of extracurriculars, whether that's a current events club, whether that's a travel club, whether that's an anime club, animation, whatever it is. But looking and asking, getting student voice involved, what kinds of clubs would students who are not involved in extracurriculars, what would they like to see here? And then see if we can support that. So that's one way I would want to reach out. I will tell you that I am a very, very visible administrator. I get to know a lot of kids. I have a pretty good radar for kids who maybe a little bit needy. Kids who are needy have a pretty good radar for me as well. And so I think the visibility is a really important thing from leadership, so that people see our job is to be out there with these kids. So when there's an issue, we find out about it. I can give you a quick example from Randolph High School. I've got this girl who is just falling apart, and she said, "I can't concentrate in that teacher's room." And I said, "You can work in my office if you can use an I statement and say, I have a problem concentrating," just so she would take responsibility for it. That's more of an AP kind of thing, but it's that kind of outreach to those kinds of kids. So she comes into my office and she works for one period a day. She's completely silent. She just needs that place. And if you have the whole school attuned to looking for those kinds of things and have those conversations, the other thing, to double back to your question about guidance, that's where I would see guidance pulling in that information, that intelligence, and working with a care and response team to say, this is what some of these kids need, and let's figure out how we can get it for them. So that's how I would approach that.
Thank you.
I'll ask a real quick question, because you talked about the evaluation tool. Definitely a very powerful tool in order to help us deliver a higher level of quality education than we have, a higher level of rigor you talked about. What's the one positive, and what's the one negative you've seen in since the tool's been mandated?
A negative for teachers or for administrators?
To the process.
Yeah, okay.
Right? Because everybody's going to have the different pros and cons, but it has probably, it's had unintended consequences.
Yes.
It's had some significant benefits to the district, to the district. Maybe let's look at it.
Right.
Look at this in the perspective of the student.
Right. So in terms of positives, between the standards and the indicators on the state tool, there's a whole lot more specificity in terms of what proficient and exemplary performance looks like. Having a common definition of exemplary across departments and even districts, I think is a pretty powerful positive. Teachers say to me, what do I need to do to become exemplary? And my first question to them is, well, what are you working on getting better at? Because in my mind, if they want to be exemplary, they have to be internally driven to get better. And they have to be thinking about, for themselves, about what they need. So I think that's a positive. The elements on well-designed lessons in Standard 1 and student engagement in Standard 2, I lean very heavily on those because they're really important to me. I think they lead to better instruction. In terms of negatives, the tool makes teachers incredibly anxious. And so just settling them down to the work takes a lot of doing. As an administrator, the volume and paperwork is overwhelming. And so I think that's another negative. I will say another positive, and I don't know if you do this here, but one thing we've done in Randolph is we have moved to doing a whole lot more very short, unannounced observations. It's been very, very positive. Teachers are used to having me around. And so they're not as anxious when I show up. You know, it's not like, you know, uh-oh, he's here. Okay, everybody, back to your work. It's more, oh, welcome back. So I'd say that's a positive, too, in the way that we've implemented.
So probably a couple minutes over, but that's okay. We'll give you an opportunity to ask us a couple questions on what you think, what our vision is or what our opinion is on anything with regard to the district.
Well, look at my notes here. And I'll come with glasses. I guess I noticed that you have an education subcommittee. There's an education reviews subcommittee. And I noticed, and this may not have been this year, it may have been last year, that you actually review mid-year and final exams that subcommittee does. My question.
You didn't review the actual.
No. Yeah, okay. I guess my question
the topic
was.
Topic of having them and when during the
year. Okay, so you weren't actually reviewing them.
No.
Oh, no.
So, because my first question would be really?
No.
We're looking at what's the value? What does it really bring?
So I guess my question would be, has there been a role for a building principal on a subcommittee like that? Or is that just a... What can you tell me about a role that I might play on?
You want to start and I'll give for a role.
So like the education subcommittee meets very much in depth with the curriculum coordinators, the principals, to discuss things that... are going to be reviewed by the committee, but more in detail, and then the subcommittee can help summarize that and bring the information back to the full committee. So we have looked at like program of studies changes, really talked to the teachers or the department chairs about what they are proposing. For instance, this past year, changing U.S. history, AP U.S. history from a two-year to a one-year, and having a real in-depth discussion about that, and other things like that. So that's the role of that. And obviously the principal and the people who are involved I mean, we had one conversation several years ago about valedictorian, having a valedictorian or not, and that was solely a conversation with the superintendent and the high school principal. That's fine. Were you there? I think you were there.
Hard to say.
Things such as class rank kids gone through there, certain whether we're going to make major changes in textbook structures, things like that. Graduation requirements. Yeah, Jenny, anything else you would add on?
We created that subcommittee because we think there's value in understanding before, let's say, program of studies is brought forward.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And also just not to chop anything up before it starts, but to understand better. And sometimes there are years there are lots of proposals. And so if we know from a budgetary perspective and can ask questions ahead of time, this may be in October, that by the time we get to December and January, we're able to bring priorities.
Right.
And you're to see able what's to feasible.
Prioritize intelligently. So it sounds like it's kind of a bridge, and there is...
It is. When clearly we're mandated to policy and budget is what our, I guess, what our purview is. However, by going deeper into specifically that area, it allows us to, whether it comes to priorities for budget, but it also gives us a lot more in-depth detail so we can maybe not prioritize, but we understand or have a better understanding of where the resources needed, not just now, but in the future. It ties into our long-range plan. It ties into what we're talking about for budget. It could tie into capital expenditures, those types of things.
Yeah, I mean, it also, you saw that the midterms and finals were on the agenda for over 2 years. We had several conversations about it. What it does allow is the longer-term discussions, to questions, without having a formal presentation at the school committee level where a decision needs to be made.
Yeah, I was interested in part because we've done a lot of work at retooling our quarterly exams, including our midyears and finals at Randolph High. I have one other question, but I did want to say one other thing. I want to make sure that I'm really clear that I am looking to sink my teeth into this position for the long term. My daughter says I'm married to my job. She says it in a nice way. I am not. I'm not the retiring type. You know, if you're wondering, I know you're not allowed to ask me those things. But so I'm going to say it. I'm looking to sink my teeth into this for 8 to 10 years. And I'm allowed to say that, so I did. I guess I would. My last question would be for the school committee: what do you see as your greatest challenge for the high school moving forward?
So, well, on the education one, do you want to answer that first, and then we can go from there?
Hiring a high school principal.
You know, that was a bad question.
I took an easy answer. Well, we're good on good questions and questions on the top. Let me think here. Challenges for the high school. I think there's a lot of them. I mean, I can tell you what I think mine might be, and my fellow committee members may not concur. I've always felt that, and I think we're there, but we got to keep it up, is the academic rigor. From the time I walked on the committee, from before, I think that's, I don't know if that's a challenge, but I think it's always a challenge because it's always changing, and it feeds into the guidance, and it feeds into the teaching, and it feeds into how you test, and it teaches how you evaluate how well a student's doing and all those things. I'll probably think of five others after this, but I think for me that's always a challenge, and it's important, and I think we've prided ourselves to get to where we are. We've talked about words like great and excellence and things like that. And you never stop. So that would be mine.
Okay.
I'm sure my colleagues have other thoughts.
Probably my personal greatest interest is that our next principal will identify with every single student to some degree or another. And what resonated with me regarding your comments is that every child shall have at least one adult that they feel comfortable discussing life with. So although this is the place for academic, it's also a place for everyday life. And you know, every class as a whole has its own sort of, maybe a stereotype or a known to be like this, or our freshmen are like this, and our sophomores are like that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't buy that.
Right.
I'm way more interested in having our next principal committed to understanding that every student has their own personal challenges as well as academic, and that there is someone there for them so that they feel they have a place.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
To go back to my question on guidance, and having just graduated my third in a row, and the college process, I think, is probably one of the areas for me. Mm-hmm. I mean, those who, others are very important, and I don't want to repeat what they've said, so I'll say that. In terms of the process of having informed one-on-one conversations, somewhat to Ginny's point of individualized conversations about the best college or the best opportunities or the best after high school opportunity. It doesn't necessarily need to be college.
Right.
Well, whatever's best for could be service, could be work, but just having the right conversations and making sure people are being directed and informed about the opportunities as well, about the after-school opportunities.
Okay, thank you.
I guess I'll kind of pull it all together, because I do believe everything that they've said. I think if I had one, it would be on the social-emotional, making sure we identify every child.
Mm-hmm.
I think that concerns me that we, you know, have surveys, and yes, we have a high majority of the students who I can identify with an adult, but we also have too many in my mind that can't. And finding out how we can get one more person, the school resource officer, if that moves our bar up, great.
Mm-hmm.
But how do then we move it even to get to all the others? Because when you look at social emotional, you've been in this business a while, it's changed a lot since you were a teacher to assistant principal to principal. So to me, it's how do we identify with that child? And a lot of what you talked about resonated with me, which is why I tack on to Paul's question earlier. And I also do think that we find out what's the best outcome for the student.
Mm-hmm.
And if the emphasis is just on the statistics of four-year, two-year schools, that to me is the wrong statistic.
Mm-hmm.
Because at that point, we're going to be putting students into, at that point, their opportunity is not going to be what's going to give them the best outcome.
Mm-hmm.
Is matching the outcome. I did like a lot your success analysis stats.
Mm-hmm.
Because to me, we've talked about that. How do we have a young alumni, right? We just finished our 13th graduating class.
Mm-hmm.
How do we, though, tap into them to make sure we made the right, suggestions to them as they go along the way? I'm with Paul. I just had two in a row go through college, and the process is
exhausting.
Yes. Well, and it's different for every child.
Right.
And, you know, I think between our five, Sue's one or three who's been through it, one who just recently, and even Ginny's who were two last year, if you looked at those five children, in that one graduating year, they have five completely different experiences because they have five different sets of needs.
Sets of needs, yes.
How do we make sure we're getting them and we're not just saying that, oh, you're not going to college, you need to go to this place or this place. That, to me, isn't doing enough for the student.
Mm-hmm.
I was happy this year.
Choices of college that you should apply to.
Exactly. Yeah, I was happy
I'm
this
sorry
year.
You said.
Or having a very limited suggested list of colleges.
Mm-hmm.
I was very happy this year that in the spring they had a second, I'd call it more of a career-oriented fair, where it had a lot of the two-year schools, the technical schools, things like that, because those, there's a population where that's the best place for that. Anyway, that's...
Can I just mention one other thing? I know this is question time, but I just did want to mention a book I used with my own children, which is called Colleges That Change Lives. We used it. We were one for two. We batted 500. We struck out with one school with one of my children. But the important thing about the book was really about assessing match rather than status. Whatever it is, that what you're really looking to do is match a child or have the child work with the guidance counselor, the parent, and teachers to match the school to their needs, their interests, their passions, all that. And I think that's a really important conversation to have. It's very easy to get trapped in, we've got this number of Ivy League students. We're going to have them, But it's also the question, I think, about match and just having that framework. Sorry, I was supposed to be asking questions.
That was helpful. Wrote it down, so. Thank you. Anything else for us?
I don't think so.
Thank you very much for your time. We appreciate you coming in and spending the time with us.
I will say, I feel like we're just starting the talk, so I would love an opportunity to continue the conversation.
Thank you.
And if I could leave these with somebody?
Absolutely.
If you're interested? Yeah. Okay, that's great. So my name is Mark Talbot, and I have been in high school education since 1991. During that time, I've held a variety of positions, and by that I mean I've done things outside of the classroom as well as in the classroom. But I was an English teacher for 18 years, loved every day of it. I miss it very much for a variety of reasons. But by the same token, after a certain amount of time, I think you're ready for the next challenge, and building administration was that challenge for me. The opportunity to maybe shape teaching and learning on a larger scale was appealing to me. And so my pursuit as a school administrator began at Dutchby High School, where I've been for the past 6 years as an assistant principal. I am part of a fabulous leadership team there, and I'm very happy and proud to be part of that team. And so the question really, Pembroke, why now, why this step? And I think it's just part of what I've been discovering all along. I think I'm ready for that step. I've learned from, in my opinion, fantastic administrators. And
I'm a South Shore guy, right? I'm from Braintree, born and raised in Braintree, spent a lot of time on the South Shore. I think the town of Pembroke and the town of Braintree have some similarities. Certainly, the socioeconomic demographic is very similar. I have friends in this community, and they describe the community of Pembroke as being made up of salt of the earth people, people who work hard and appreciate right from wrong, and appreciate the value in strong leadership, and people who are working together to help kids succeed. So, you know, I certainly think that that's a perfect fit for me, because that's exactly what I believe in. You know, I love the town of Braintree. I've been there my entire life. My kids, I went to the Braintree Public Schools, my kids go to the Braintree Public Schools, and I really value the community nature of the school system there. And my friends who live in Pembroke tell me the same thing here, and I've heard the same thing about this community from numerous people. So I think it's a good fit for me. And I think I am ready to take that next step. I think that my time at Duxbury High School has prepared me for lots and lots of things. And I'm happy to become part of a new leadership team and work with people and learn new things and apply what I've learned here.
Can you start?
Sure, I'll start. It's my nature to sort of let you know ahead of time that we try and give each of the candidates similar questions.
Sure.
So just so you know that. One of the things that I'd like you to talk about is the wellness in terms of behavioral, emotional high school students and what you think the challenges are now, even maybe anecdotally some of your experiences. And we would like you to talk about the subject of bullying.
Sure. You know, I think that any school administrator, any school employee for that matter, I think that whether they like it or not, the social and emotional well-being of our students has become really at the forefront. It's a part of our discussions every day, and those discussions involve people from across the entire school building. So I think everyone who works with students needs to be prepared to help students navigate the very difficult social environment that our teenagers are confronted with today. Social media does nothing but exacerbate those difficulties, in my opinion. I think as adults we use it very well. I think I use it very well, but I think as kids, sometimes, not sometimes, a lot of times, it does great harm to them. So, like all school administrators, I have a great deal of experience working with and helping the social and emotional needs of our students. I'm part of two standing committees that meet weekly. The first is our student assistance team, which meets every Wednesday with the guidance staff and our school psychologists and the assistant principals, where we talk about students who are at risk, students who are struggling. Academically, certainly, but primarily with social and emotional difficulties. And so there we game plan as a team, and we triage as a team, and we develop strategies to help kids who are in need. It's a very important meeting. Tomorrow at 9:30, we're going to have it tomorrow, and you know, I look forward to it. I look forward to working with that group of people. The second meeting is the building-based support team, and that team meets every Tuesday afternoon. That meeting tends to focus more on academics, but academics that maybe are impacted by social and emotional struggles. And so again, we talk about different strategies to help the kids access the curriculum successfully, in-class accommodations perhaps. We discuss there every Tuesday afternoon. In addition to that, I'm happy to have been a part of a couple of different programs at Duxbury High School geared towards helping the social and emotional learners. We have a substantially separate special education program at our school, and there's a flow chart that determines eligibility for that program, and certainly part of it is an IEP. And that program is in its third year, and it's been it's fluid, it's developing every day. The staff there is fantastic, and their professional and student learning goals each year are intended to improve the program and student learning in some way, shape, or form. But I think what that program revealed is we needed a program for kids who aren't on an IEP, for kids who are regular education students with disability who are also struggling. And so this year we piloted what was called the COAST program. And we just got the blessing last week that that program will be funded for next year as well. And it operates similarly to our partnership program. It runs out of our guidance department, where students have a home base. Students who are assigned to the COAST program have a home base, and there's a coordinator there, a young aspiring guidance counselor, who we were lucky enough to bring on board as a part-time counselor this year. She became the coordinator of that program during its pilot stage, and she's also been hired recently to carry that through now next year as it blossoms into a more solidified program. But those kids check in the morning with her at the home base, and they go about their day. And if they are having a period of difficulty, if they can't get to a class, if they're stuck, then they stay with her. The work comes down. She helps to kind of navigate the academic piece, coordinate assignments coming in and out. The goal is every day to have the kids in their classes, but we know that's not always going to happen. And so we provide a respite for those students, a place where they can come and stay and still maintain a foot in the academic world, right? It's not perfect because they're missing instruction. But work does get sent down. She does remediate as best as she can, and we try to triage and get the kids back into the regular schedule as fast as we possibly can. That program is growing by the day because the need is there. So we're looking forward to ways in which we can improve that program, enlarge that program. But we're very happy to have gotten the blessing to run it full-time next year as part of a budgeted position. Your FTE is involved. It's terrific. You know, I guess the short answer to that question is it's not a short answer, right? I do have a great deal of experience working with this population. I don't have all the answers, but I'm happy to report that we have had a modicum of success helping our students navigate this very difficult time.
Good start.
Yeah. Thank you.
To be continued.
Yeah.
Any follow-ups? I'm going to change gears and,
sure.
and keeping the same questions, same genre. How would you, as you mentioned, our community is very important and our parent community is very important
sure.
to our schools. How would you engage them as being new to the community as well as communicate with them? That's a very important piece of the model to have our administrators, particularly our high school principal, communicate with the parent community as well as the community.
Right, absolutely agree. And we work on that every day at Westbury High School. So, you know, certainly the more fundamental communication tools, you know, email blasts, connect ed blasts, we use our website certainly for various communication modalities. I'm on Twitter, I've been social media, right, and I'm proud to have 541 followers, right? You know, so our electorate has about 3,000, which sometimes makes you feel a little bit inferior, but. So we tweet an awful lot. We tweet in the moment. We tweet the forecast. I think that being present and being visible a lot, as often as I can be, helps with the communication piece. Certainly a lot of those informal conversations, I just noticed downstairs, there were two different events at once. There was something in the auditorium and something in the cafeteria. You know, being present at those things and those lobby conversations are very important to parents, and they're very important to me, you know, because that's where sometimes you can really have some great opportunities to interact with people in a much more relaxed environment. So, you know, my strategies, again, are to be very proactive in the communication piece. I email parents frequently. I call parents frequently. And I like to be present. I like to be visible. I want parents to know that I'm available to them because I know what they have to say is important to them, and so therefore it's important to me.
Paul?
Sure.
Can you share some thoughts on the guidance department in terms of, say, in 3 years, what would you like the guidance department to be known for or to be people to say about that particular guidance department in terms of social, emotional, as well as academic and college process?
Yeah, sure. So I think certainly, you know, the role of the guidance counselor is so multitudinal, right? So many purposes, and it's growing again by the day. But I certainly would like all of our counselors to be well-versed in college and career readiness, the college application process, I want them to be squared away with advising students on what their post-secondary education plans are and how they can best attain those plans. So, a big part of the course is then the college application process. I want our guidance staff to be known as a department that can be depended upon by students and families to help them navigate the difficulties that face our students every day. And again, it's academic, it's emotional, it's social, it's familial, it's all of these various things. I want the guidance staff, and again, I have no reason to think it's not this, right? But I want the guidance staff to be dependable. I want parents to know that if they contact the guidance counselor, that message is important. And it's not going to sit in the inbox for 48 hours before a response comes. So in short, it's important that the community knows that that department is squared away and that they can be relied upon to meet the various needs of our kids.
Thank you. I'm actually going to come off script a little bit because there's something you said in your opening statement that caught my attention. You talked about Braintree being a lot like Pembroke.
Sure.
I agree, but how, I understand, we in Pembroke want our own identity, which is one of the reasons we withdrew from Silver Lake.
Sure.
How do you, though, look at what you've done in Duxbury? What would you apply it to Pembroke? Yeah. So how are we similar, and how would you expand upon some of the things you've done in Duxbury? And then ask on the other side, how are we different, and what would you do in order to address some of those things where we're different to make sure whether they're successes or things we need to work on?
Mm. Well, that is a challenging question.
It was intended to be.
Yeah. Boy. I think that that's a difficult question to answer, only in that I am elbow deep in the Duxbury community, right, in that culture. And so I have a real strong sense of where that community is at. I'm not elbow deep in the community of Pembroke, and so I don't necessarily have as good of a feel for that. And so some of the decisions around programming, around attempts to involve community, I would need to get a feel first for where I am, right, before I make those decisions.
That's fair. Let me just give you a little bit of hope on this then. If, based upon what you know, not that we would hold you to it, if you said you're going to do program A, B, and C,
right,
we're looking for that in September. Let's not, just based upon the limited knowledge you have, understanding, again, you haven't met with the parents, you haven't met the student population. What do you think right now coming in about you would bring from Duxbury into Pembroke, and what do you think we would want you would do differently than you're doing in Duxbury?
I mean, based on some of the questions here, I'm sensing there's a strong concern about social and emotional well-being for students. Okay, so in addition to some of the programming that I spoke about, I would like to take a hard look at what Pembroke High School is doing for that population and how I could bring some of what we've done at Duxbury to Pembroke. And then, of course, there's also some of the outside programming that we've done, some of the assemblies and some of the presentations for students that we've used at Duxbury High School around social and emotional well-being. We've had two speakers this year come in in response to episodes in the Duxbury student body community. And we brought in some speakers to address those types of behaviors because we saw a need for that. So, you know, that kind of programming, that kind of being in tune with the student body in their needs, and then trying to bring in something from the outside into our school as another voice to reach our kids, that's something that we do at Duxbury that I'd be certainly looking forward to doing here at Pembroke. You know, we took a long, hard look at our schedule at Duxbury High School. You know, quite frankly, the schedule that we were pushing for was not adopted by the faculty. They did not accept our suggestions for a change to our schedule. I think that may have been a mistake on the part of our faculty. And I'd like to take a look at the schedule here. By the way, the schedule here is very similar to the one that I proposed at Duxbury High School. But ways to use directed study halls during the day to help students, not only help students, help faculty collaborate. Ways to get creative with that schedule. I don't know what the collaboration opportunities are for the staff here, but there's an opportunity within the day to do that on the school's time without expending resources. So how to look at that scheduling flexibility to see if there's a way to bring those ideas that did not necessarily come to fruition here in the Pembroke. And again, that depends on what I would find once I was in the position, like what the needs were. I would continue to work hard with the community that I have at Duxbury, making those connections outside of the classroom with our students. Because again, it's important that the students have a sense of trust in you. It's important that the students have a sense that they can rely upon you and they have an opportunity to get to know you outside of your role as administrator. And I enjoy making those connections outside of the classroom with the kids. You know, it's one of the things I miss the most about teaching, you know, is the opportunity to do that, teaching and coaching. So, you know, those are some of the things I do now that I would certainly look right away to do here in Pembroke.
So, continuing, you said something about collaboration within the faculty.
Sure.
I'm curious to how you would be the best cheerleader for your teachers and how you would engage that group of people.
Right.
We certainly talk about our students, number one.
Right.
We don't want to leave out the discussion.
Absolutely.
For being the best cheerleader.
And I do feel as though I am a cheerleader for teachers, and I hope that my staff will feel the same way. I enjoy working with teachers in the evaluation process. I think that the new evaluation model is exceptional. I think it is so good for both teachers and for students, because the opportunity to give real-time feedback to teachers and then have the ability to follow up and see that have an effect or not and make other adjustments, I just think that's an opportunity now that did not exist under the old model. You know, I am a teacher. That's what I consider myself, you know, and I think I was a good teacher. And I don't mean to sound, you know, too full of myself, but I enjoy it, and I enjoy being in the classroom. I enjoy observing lessons. I enjoy giving feedback. I enjoy partnering teachers who may be struggling with a certain pedagogical strategy with those who are exceptional at it, and I enjoy finding time to make that observation of a classroom happen. You know, one of the goals that we are trying still to accomplish in Duxbury is to get our teachers collaborative time during the school day. And it does revolve around coverage of directed study halls and grouping by period, study hall coverage by department. So that period one is English and period two is social studies. And then if we can free up the English 9 teachers during that study hall one day and they go teach and get those kids covered with the rest of the teachers and let those guys work on real teaching and learning strategies and they can do it once a cycle so that they can see in, you know, in real time what they're doing and what the impact they're having is, you know, those are commitments that are very strong. I'm strong committed to that, and like I said, it didn't work out too well for us in Duxbury this year, but we're not going to stop trying to get that to you know, be agreeable to the teachers there. But I love being in classrooms. I love walking through the rooms, you know, and just without even a device or a pad of paper, just walking through and seeing what's happening and having those hallway conversations about what I thought was what worked really well.
Since we have time, I'll add on to it. How might you connect with the teaching community and the staff outside of those formal observations and those formal evaluations?
Again, I hate to keep you the same answer to these questions, but I just think that being visible, being present, being around is important. It doesn't have to be in the classroom. It can be in the cars. It can be at an athletic event. My office door, I hope that my staff would say, if they were here, that my door is open and they can come in and talk to me about whatever they want. In fact, I enjoy some of those times. I get to work. We have a late start in Duxbury, so I get to work at about 7 o'clock in the morning. We don't start at 8:20. So I enjoy very much at 7:30 when I'm in my office doing something, a teacher coming in, sitting down, just shooting the breeze about anything, not just even academics. I enjoy that opportunity to build those relationships with the people with whom I work. And again, I hope they would say the same thing. I hope they find that that's genuine. So I think there are plenty of times for administrators and teachers to get together, inside of school, outside of school, social events. You know, I said at an earlier stage in the interview process that was one of the things that I thought was lacking a little bit faculty getting together outside of the school, realm of the school operations. We started the Faculty Unity Network, FUN, FUN, the FUN team we started. And so and that was with the help of a couple of great, energetic young teachers. And this is the second year of the FUN Network, and they have planned social outings for faculty. And the administration is an important part of it. They're welcome to attend always, and we do attend, and those are great times. So to me, those are important. Those events are important in building relationships so that we know that we're all here together and we're all on the same team and that everyone's working towards the same goal. I love that as a teacher. I love those Friday afternoon moments as a teacher. I love them, so.
Sure. I think we're somewhat at an advantage or disadvantage in that we have visited your school recently. You talked to a lot of the...
I'm aware, yes.
We heard of... So tell us a little bit about some of the ways that the school and the administration and the teachers are engaging students that may be not participating in some of like the more formal ways that people are engaged in school, athletics,
right.
music,
right.
those kind of things. How is Duxbury reaching out to the kids who may be falling through the cracks?
Sure. So we have a ceremony today. And if you follow me on Twitter, if you're one of my 541 followers, you would have started. We have
545.
Yeah, we have a celebration to recognize students for acts of random kindness. It's called the Best of the Bunch Celebration, and it's very simply, it's twice a year, once in the winter and once in the spring, where teachers nominate students for doing nothing other than being kind to someone. Out of the blue, right? At those times when no one notices you just picked up that piece of paper, or you helped her with her bag, or you held the door for her. Simple things like that. And we recognized this morning 50 students. We had the parents come in. We have a little breakfast. It's a nice ceremony in our cafeteria. And I'm happy to be a co-MC at that event. And it's a wonderful day. But it's only 2 days, right? We do it once in the winter and once in the spring. And so there have to be other ways, right, to engage these students. So we hold activity fairs in the beginning of the year during our advisory period. So every club, every organization sets up a table right along our main street, the big corridor down our building, with poster boards, with handouts, with gum and candy to try to, you know, tantalize some potential signer-uppers. We run that advisory fair for our freshmen and for our sophomores every October so that kids who maybe don't know of a club's existence, of an opportunity to find a niche, they know that they have a chance to find that niche. I run an open table for suggestions for clubs and activities. We have, at Duxbury right now, we have over 45 clubs and activities for our students, and I would say that 12 of them, and could be more, I'm just approximating, 12 of them are grassroots, started by kids who have come to me that said, we want this club, we don't have this club, can we try this club? And there's a process by which they can do that. The most important part of that process is finding a volunteer chef, adult who cannot get paid for that because there's no money in the budget, but they do. You know, so we have an animal welfare club, we have a helping hand club, we have a gardening club, we have a Pokemon club. We have clubs that are started because kids are looking for some sort of attachment to our community outside of the school bed. So, again, we're not perfect at that. There are still kids, unfortunately, who we feel as though are looking for that place to fit in. But, you know, we're constantly trying to find things for them and try to reach that population.
Kids, a quick question before I ask my real question statistics-wise. Do you know what your percentage of students who participate in sports in clubs or in the total number of students who participate in at least one activity? Do you have an idea?
I do. It's in the 84-85% of our kids participate in something, at least one thing. We've looked at that. We try to tease that out. Because so many kids do multiple things, that makes that data difficult to tease out sometimes. But based on the research we've done in the past few years, at the request of our school council and our school committee, in looking at student stress, that's really what caused us to kind of dive into those numbers.
So it's fair, basically, 7 out of 8 students participate in at least one activity within the school?
Yeah, I would say that's probably fair. 8 out of 10, I think that's fair. Yeah, you say that.
Thank you for that. The question I have is, or first, you may be aware, Pembroke funded a school resource officer through town meeting, so the community at large feels there's a need for a school resource officer, something this committee has wanted for several years, since Pembroke High School has been in existence, and we finally got funding this year. It'll be split half-time between high school and middle school, so assuming that you'll have the resource officer in the building half-time, when he or she starts during the middle of next school year after they get trained, what would you feel, or how would you envision their role? Talk a little bit about how you've worked with resource officers in the past, and what do you think, how can they help engagement, how can they help within the education, what's your vision?
Yeah, so fortunately, I have an outstanding relationship with the SRO at Dushbury High School. We consider him part of our leadership team. When he's available, he attends our standing building leadership meetings every Monday morning. And we, Officer Weiler is an integral part of what we do. And so maybe he's a bit unique, and it would take time for an SRO in Pembroke to kind of develop that and foster those relationships with kids. But I think it's so important. I'm so happy to hear that. I'm happy for your community. And so some of the ways, certainly, that I would envision using an SRO, certainly, for some programming in schools, right? Again, finding the time to do that, I would need to know more about the structure of your school day, right? And when there are times available to incorporate some of the many, many important lessons and education that an SRO could impart, but certainly around social responsibility with social media, digital citizenship, you know, what the law says about bullying and cyberbullying, what the law says about, you know, risky behaviors outside of the classroom, you know, on the weekends and things of that nature. We use our SRO to talk to our kids about those issues and then some. He visits PE classes. He visits history classes. Whenever the curriculum, whenever there's an appropriate part in the curriculum for him to speak to our students, we make sure he does so. He's super willing to do that. He's so very cooperative. He is present at all of the school functions. He's an important part of the orderly operations of a prom, of a homecoming dance, of a homecoming football game. So our kids recognize him as a member of our staff, without any question. So, you know, I discussed this at an earlier part of the interview process as well. You know, the relationship between the school and the SRO really is only as strong as the MOU that's signed between the schools and the police department. And that's an important piece of all that. So, you know, sharing information about student well-being is an important part of that relationship. You know, if students are engaging in risky behavior on a Saturday night and the police department finds out about that, you know, does the schools want that information shared with them from the police department? And will the MOU allow for that? And vice versa. If I am concerned about a student's well-being during the school day, and some of the concerns might involve illegal activity, does the school department want that information shared with the SRO? These are decisions that we made. I'm sure you all understand that. And the MOU would certainly frame that. My personal opinion is, yes, that information needs to be shared because it is a community effort. We do need to keep our kids safe. And it doesn't make much sense for the various stakeholders to withhold information. We know we can help one another out. So, I find the SRO to be an invaluable part of high schools in the 21st century.
We're just about at 30 minutes. Well, we want to make sure we give you an opportunity.
I'm having a great time. You guys can ask me as many questions as you want.
Unfortunately, it's a tough day. I would love to believe you. Kind of the wrong thing to say to this one.
Right.
So keep it for a while. Just ask when we get to meet superintendent. So we appreciate you coming in. But we want to make sure we give you time because this is obviously a dual choice for us, mostly for the superintendent.
Right.
But but our school community, but as well as you, have to
sure.
feel, make sure you feel comfortable. This is a major career move. You're coming, you'd be leaving Duxbury after, you know, several years. It's not something you'd be lightly. So what questions would you have for us as a committee that you haven't asked the administrators?
Sure. So I guess the primary question I have is, what is the school community's vision for the students as we head into the 21st century? What overarching plans does the committee have to help our kids develop those 21st century skills so that they are ready for the next step? You know, is there a long-term technology plan? Is there curriculum review processes that, you know, that are ongoing or not? I
mean, there's a sure. Let me just ask, answer two of the logistic questions, and I'll turn it over sure. to Ginny, Sue, Paul, and then I'll kind of fill in some blanks at the end. Yes, well, there is a, as you know, we have a new superintendent. Part of what she has been asked to do is take her one-year bridge technology plan now and come up with what the technology plan looks like. The plan we had expired, it had expired, and it was a little dated because it was an old vision. So we're asking her to come up with what that new vision is, and that's due in short time. We are doing some tactical changes. Okay, then that's for the next meeting. We are doing some tactical changes that will support a long-term technology plan, so that's the first thing. That's one question. Second, on curriculum, one of the things we do have is Mary Beth in her role, very strong in her role, let's say that, with her here and with her not here, and she's done a lot of amazing work to make sure we're getting aligned. We moved into department chairs. We're calling them that this year, right? Content coordinators. It's changed titles over.
Are they 9 through 12 or?
They're
K through 12.
So we're trying to get alignment, you know, across
sure, and absolutely.
You know, vertically and horizontally.
Sure.
And, you know, that we've made a major investment in that over the past year. And we're starting to see it pay dividends. So there is structure for that. One of the things that we've done as a committee consciously is whenever we had to make cuts, we spared the classroom less. So we've run administratively thin. And we feel strongly that the content coordinators and Mary Beth's position is classroom positions. So we've invested heavily in that and done everything we can to cut as much what people would consider infrastructure and overhead. We did a presentation to the Board of Selectmen, and we were well below the state average in dollars per non-classroom items. We were below the state average, we were below our predecessor district, the Silver Lake. So we've achieved our goal in that, and to really drive curriculum and try to drive excellence education. So right. I think answer your first couple questions, I think.
Yeah.
Logistics stuff. Now I'll let Ginny, Sue, Paul answer any vision questions.
I think some of my colleagues would like you to know. Our thought and our vision, in addition to technology, in addition to our being very careful with our budget and protecting the classroom, another subject area that we're looking forward to with our new high school principal is communicating a positive message, so that whether or not you do have families that are sending students to school every day or not, that the community knows that positivity is breeding positivity, because as we talked about, social media seems to be a hotbed for a lot of criticism, and it doesn't always seem balanced. So one of the things that we identified with the superintendent selection process, and that we're going to bring forward to our next high school principal, is how would you share the vision of our school committee with each of our principals in creating dedicated plans for positive messages.
Right.
We think we have a lot to celebrate, and it seems to be a tendency for some people to focus on the negative. And it's real easy to get on a roll.
You got that right. Yeah.
So that's probably another message that we would like you to know that we're interested in
right.
providing for our communities.
And to add on, in terms of vision or whatever, I think it's important to know that as a school committee, we approved two new social workers, is that the right term?
Mm-hmm.
For this particular school budget, additional social workers, which we didn't have before. So I think it's really recognizing that social-emotional aspect and the engagement and all that that is a priority to us as a school committee.
Sure.
And making the investments for the, what's your term, well-rounded? Well, whatever. Jeannie always says it the best, I think. The whole student.
Yeah. Right. Sure.
Everything.
Now, will those psychologists, social workers be housed with guidance, or are they going to be with student services, or will they be?
So there's one elementary and one secondary. We haven't decided where.
Okay.
What the next will look like just yet. It depends on who we find in the pool.
Great.
Susan, anything you want
to add? Just that we always continue to strive for academic excellence at all grade levels, at all levels.
Sure.
You know, and academic rigor. I mean, that's just the underlying tone. And now the challenge in the 21st century is, you know, how to use technology and, you know, kind of feeds into the technology plan and the curriculum. How can we do that to continue to do that well?
Right. And where do those tech standards fit into our existing curriculum? That's a challenge.
One of the things during the superintendent search, but also just in general, technology for technology's sake, to say you have invested X dollars is probably a bad idea. We heard both schools who have a one-to-one. We've heard schools that have one-to-many. We've heard schools with BYOD. Every time we've looked at each model, they've had, everybody's raved about pieces. They've talked about pieces that didn't work. And
right.
You're one-to-one.
Correct.
But you don't allow BYOD, correct?
Correct.
That's a little bit of a challenge, right? Because then if you can't go one-to-one, which is, for us, not economically
right
possible.
Now, right, yeah.
We have to do BYOD, which creates different challenges than you have. So I think that that's important, you know, how we involve technology, but then also you involving it in the right spots. Is it supporting education,
correct,
again, or is it just saying you're doing it for
sure
that? The one thing that wasn't mentioned is, as a district, we've made an investment, but we've also seen the payback within our arts program. I think we recognize as one of the top performing arts schools, you know, in the nation. That's something we put a lot of pride in. One of the events you saw was an elementary concert.
Correct, yeah.
We have, when you see the number of concerts, it's just amazing. We're now at the point we've outgrown our only facility to hold our all band or all choral night.
Right.
We now have to figure out a way how we can still do that, bring everybody together, but then allow everybody who wants to see it. That to me is another place. It kind of goes to the whole student. We talk about social emotional, we talk about athletics, we talk about trying to get the kids with the clubs. I think we feel the same way as what you said. You know, I'll do it because of student engagement, and there are different reasons why kids come to school.
Right.
And we have to figure out how. We have approximately 1,000 students might meet 1,000 different ways on why they come to school each day.
Right. Well, the research is undeniable, right? The kids who have a reason to come here are the ones who do well, right? The statistics, they don't lie, you know. So, yeah, I agree. It's an important point.
What else would you like to ask us?
I mean, there's so many things. I mean, a lot of it is more logistical, right? A lot of it is what would happen when, what happens within this building, and that's stuff that I'm going to have to figure out if I'm lucky enough to get this job, and I'm certainly, you know, willing to navigate that, you know. I would just ask, you know, and you have certainly kind of expressed this, right? What is it you're looking for in your next principal? What personal characteristics would you like him or her to have? And what do you want him or her to do, you know? And I think you've expressed some of that already, so I certainly need to be redundant or to drag anything out, but that's certainly a question that I would have of all of you, not only tonight, but if I were to get the job the next night, and the next night, and the next night, because I know there's probably a lot of answers to that question, you know? So.
Well, we're not shy, so.
Yeah, you should.
Stay tuned.
You should.
Well, thank you for time. We appreciate you coming in. And hopefully answer your questions. And thank you.
Yeah, no, thank you. I hope I answered your questions. I appreciate you having me. Thank you all very much, and good luck. And good luck with your decision. Thank you very much.
Let's take we're going to take a few minutes and give everyone our feedback, understand the short hire. Two comments I want to make just to start. Number one, thank you for bringing two qualified candidates to us, and thank you for bringing candidates to us. And a lot of times we've seen in the recent past, it's shifted not out of desire by the committee, but I think just whatever, it has not been the practice in a while to bring the candidates to us for us to meet us. We appreciate that, although it is your hire. It's tough to feel everything about an individual in a 30-minute interview. We saw this with the candidates. I think we learned a lot during site visits. I'm sure you learned a lot. I'm sure every group that met with your four finalists and even your semifinalists prior to that has different opinions and had different experiences. So what I'd like us to do is go around the table and talk about what we saw with the two candidates to give Erin some feedback, and then so that she can take into her deliberations. Anybody from the audience, after we go through these guys, if you want to give any feedback, you'll do it. Why am I surprised? That's right. We'll just give you the opportunity to weigh in.
Thank you.
We saw two different candidates, and then give everybody a chance to say a couple things about each, if that's okay. So if we could start in the same order we did the questions, we'll go Ginny, Sue, Paul, myself. Is that okay?
Sure. So my feedback to you, Erin. Both were really, I think, exceptional people. And it comes down to how much can we do you in these 30 minutes. My observation is around somebody's the style. So for Mr. Graham.
I'm sorry, would you repeat that?
Sorry, Jimmy.
I couldn't hear you.
Sorry. Somebody has to interpret.
Sorry.
Okay.
I'll
sign. So style. I see confidence and enthusiasm with both. And I see that the anecdotal contribution from Mr. Frank seemed to just roll. He seems to be very much a conversationalist. So the question will be, and he talked very much about visibility and interactive. So I think by personality, how he demonstrated with us was to be able to face-to-face kind of pull up a chair and speak from his multitude of experiences. Now, I don't know whose age is what, and I'm not implying that there's that, or, breadth of experience, or... again, their styles are just different. I think the experience with Mr. Talbot, his way of communicating to us was a little bit more in terms of program. So I'm not saying that one was better than the other, but I do feel that I would like more information, I think, from both of them. And since I can't personally have that right now, I will leave it to you. And that's a nice way of saying it's Suzanne's turn.
They both have, I mean, they both, I'm going to repeat what Mike said, they're both great candidates, thank you. I think it comes down to, like, everything else and every other decision we make in terms of personnel. It's fit. It's fit for the time we are now. It's fit for who the personnel that we have in place and the world we live in today. And the exciting things that we do have on our horizon with some new hires. I like both of their enthusiasm for the students and their engagement. I mean, they wouldn't be doing it if we didn't look at, right? But to feel it and hear it, to me, made me feel comfortable with both of them in terms of that. I don't have a way either or. Sorry, I'm not going to be able to give that to you. Maybe another couple hours and then I'd be able to give that to you. But I think it comes down to fit. You know, I'm not good at, like, picking apart interviews. You know, I try to stay with the positive and, you know. I like the visibility, the idea of being visible. I like the idea, like, you said enthusiasm. When you said enthusiasm, I was like, yeah, that's it. That's the word I've been, like, trying to put down. I'm going to keep it simple. Simpler yet.
I think both candidates were very strong. I think they, when they talked about to your question, Mike, about the school resource officer, I think they both gave very similar answers and very similar approaches to that particular position. Engagement, their answers were very similar, talked about clubs, talked about finding what students wanted. I mean, it was really from a, just the types of questions that we were asking, a lot of them, they really had a lot of very similar answers. So it was really hard to differentiate the two. And so to me, it would really come down to fit. I mean, I'm not going to be the one having to talk to them on a daily basis. But I mean, and I think based upon what I heard, I don't think you could go wrong with either one.
So can I echo those sentiments to everybody else? I feel comfortable, I will feel comfortable sending my child here next year with either one of them as a principal. So that's definitely a positive. On the team thing, I know for myself, whenever I have hires for my team, I always look for somebody who's different than what we already have. Because you want that diversity of opinions, diversity of backgrounds. So I think that's one thing I would suggest considering when you look at the two candidates and you make the hire. Let me point out, there are a couple of things I thought were different, or a couple of things I thought each of them said that really stood out to me. With Josh, pardon me, just how I have them written on the paper or where they are. I liked when you talked to the school resource officer about teen dating violence. That's something we did, the soccer team did last year, brought in the White Ribbon campaign. We've tried to do that a lot the last few years and had moderate success, but thankfully the boys hockey team did a good job extending that. And I think teen dating violence is important. It's an important topic, you know, and we need to, it's one of the areas of social emotional that we're not, we haven't talked about a lot. I like his answer on the evaluation tool. It was a positive. Talked about the positives and the negatives. I think he hit on the negatives that we all understood, but the positives I thought were really good. I really liked his comment about the student the success analysis stats. We talked about that for a few years, but he made a point to bring it up outside. And I liked the statistics around the grad rate and knowing that he had a good handle of the measures and what to where to go with all the students. On engaging teachers, support to help teachers do what he was talking about as far as student engagement, I thought was positive, and getting kids interested in school, I thought was obviously a very positive, which I liked. The building relationship with the students, I thought he had a good answer. What I was concerned about, he only brought up one detail about one student. There wasn't I kind of put in my lack of detail, and then he came up with the one example of the student he brings into his office. And knowing the Randolph population, it's probably a big one. I was waiting for more. You know, that's probably the only thing I'd say is a drawback of what he didn't say in his interview, because there were a lot of positives. I thought this, again, what school resource officer is very good. With Mark, I thought he got off a little bit slow. I was waiting to hear what Paul mentioned about the DOTS program, but I kept looking back to, I know we talked about a lot.
It doesn't exist.
It doesn't exist yet. It's in proposal, and we knew that. That's why I know it hasn't happened. We heard about it during one interview that it did, and when we found out during the site visit, it's still in proposal and still in implementation. But to me, that's important enough to maybe bring up that you're thinking of it, and I was kind of disappointed. He talked about risky behaviors with the SRO. I thought was good. I did like the fact he talked about it's only as good as the memorandum of understanding, which we've known about and we've seen throughout our 13 years here. I did like the act of random kindness to try and engage the kids. I thought that was great. The participation of the 80-45% was positive. We're in the 60s as far as athletics, and we're probably closer to 75, I'm guessing, a little bit lower than they are overall. So I thought that was positive. I did like the new clubs and then trying to make sure the kids work a little bit and adding 12. I thought that was great. I like the communication time during the day to try and get teachers in the study hall piece was, I thought, interesting, an interesting concept. I'll still kind of go back to, just on the one negative part. It still stuck with me, which is why I asked the question about he tied Braintree to Pembroke, but never tied Duxbury to Pembroke. And even the answer, there wasn't a lot to it. Mm-hmm. Again, I'm not trying to pick, I'm just trying to grab all the positives I heard from each, but also kind of one or two of the negatives. So overall, I liked both of them.
And I think it's a tough, I think it's a tough call, so.
Go up.
No, I, so, at that, anybody else here? So, let anybody else want to share?
No, I was pointing to you.
I'd love to share. I'll share. I work for Pembroke Public Schools, so I was really invested in it. I have to say, and I don't mean it disrespectfully, I don't know either of these men. I wasn't on your committee, truthfully. It's not personal. I thought Mr. Frank stood out far and above Mr. Talbot. I thought he was really well-spoken, right on point, knew about our school system, which was impressive. He talked about guidance. He's like, there's four guidance people, right? He talked about his vision. I felt like he had a vision. Mr. Talbot, don't mean me. I know he works in Duxbury, but I don't feel like he had his own vision. And I think a school principal should be a leader, and I feel like Mr. Frank was a leader, and I felt like Mr. Talbot was like, this is what I've learned, this is what I've learned. I'm like, what do you want? And I felt like Mr. Frank kept speaking. I mean, I have notes, and Mr. Frank has a lot more notes. But I thought he really, I loved everything he said about the staff and accountability. He was really on that. Not just students, the way he was talking about, you know, not punishing, but confronting and naming it. And I was like, yes. Go, brother, go. You know, like, I thought he was excellent. And so, if you're asking me, I'm going to say it. I like Mr. Thank you very much.
And I'll just say, having sat on the search committee, I don't know if I'm allowed to say that or not,
you sure?
Say that, and having the opportunity to meet both of them now twice, and Mr. Frank stood out to me from the get-go. Everybody that we met, I thought was fine, but he shone to me. Like, I just was like, oh, I really like him. Like, all the other candidates we met, I was like, yeah, I like them, they'd be fine. But there was just something, he has a calming demeanor. You can tell he's highly educated. You can tell he loves children. And this is not anything against the second candidate, but just having met them all, and I really was reserving tonight because I said, okay, just because I liked him then, that was 1 hour. Who knows? I'm like, maybe when I see him tonight, I won't feel the same way. I felt exactly the same way. I really think he could move our high school forward. And under Aaron's leadership and in the direction where we want to go in a positive direction with our high school. So I really liked him.
Yes, if you want to add
anything. I was just going to say, I thought Mr. Frank was very heartfelt, like very polished, very like meant what he said, like every time he was speaking to me. And again, he just had that like subtle tone over him. Where the other guy just, I don't know, it seemed like he was kind of telling us a lot about where he came from versus what he would be doing for us. I don't know, the way he answered each one of your questions, I thought that Mr. Frank just really said it with emotion and meant it. I don't know, like I said, I've only, again, just as much as you guys have, but that was definitely my thought too.
I
didn't take notes, so I feel a little bad. I don't have anything to back up what
we
I have to say.
We can go home if you want.
But my general feeling from just hearing both of them for the first time tonight was that Mr. Frank was presenting proactive ideas, and then I felt that the other candidates' ideas were more reactive, or his solutions to problems were more reacting to problems, and once there's a problem, here's what I do, versus I felt like with the bullying and some of the other things, Mr. Frank was more proactive and had more ideas as how to maybe prevent things. So, off the cuff, that was my general impression.
Yeah, that was all. I would agree with all the comments made. So, all four of you made. It was positive, and it was just interesting. I do think both of them would be very capable high school principals. The question.
No. Everyone.
Is there anybody else? I did want to say, I'd like Frank's answer to the questions about evaluation, about how it affects teachers, how it affects administration, impact on students, his visibility, how he has a calming influence on the teachers because of his visibility. And I'd like that, he was very willing to admit it is overwhelming for administration to manage. I mean, he knows he's got to do it, and he knows it's there, but I liked his honesty about it. He's very genuine.
I really like the fact that when we talk about Math Fest, about the positives, because it's supposed to be a positive tool. It's not meant to go in and, I know it makes feel, everybody feels uncomfortable when they're getting, right, when they're getting observed. You feel just, okay, all the eyes are on me. And it shouldn't be that way. It should be, how do we, pardon me, help people get better who want to get better.
Right.
So, and he definitely answered, I thought, that question really well. Yeah. And he actually brought it, the reason why I asked the question is he actually brought it out in his opening statement, which I thought was positive and important, so.
One thing, the only other, I guess, an additional comment that I have, I think we all saw that it's hard from a 30-minute interview to really get a feel for someone, and I know from our experience with the superintendent search, that the site visit and the longer term meeting of people in different scenarios can be totally different than what you see sitting in front of you at that particular point.
So just to build on that a little bit, in addition to tonight's 30 minutes, I sat down with each of them for a solid hour and asked kind of more in-depth, resume-specific questions, trying to figure out the fit. Because I think that, for me, is the most important piece, understanding that both of them would be wonderful candidates as a high school principal. But looking at what we have as strengths already as a district and what somebody else can bring to the table. We did get a lot of information through the site visits. Obviously, there's referencing. So there's more than just tonight. Tonight, I think, was just a snapshot. But we have been gathering a ton of information on each of them and come to the same conclusion that the four of you did, that both of them would be great. I think that Mr. Frank does have a longer administrative experience, but for me, that doesn't necessarily equate a better fit for us. So I think, you know, when you speak about proactive versus reactive answers to questions, I think Mr. Frank did rely a lot on the experiences that he had that in middle school in Wellesley as opposed to a high school in Randolph. So to me, that was a little bit challenging to make the connection as far as that piece. And I agree, Mark would be a green administrator here. So as much as we're looking for someone that's a fit, we're also looking for someone that brings something to the table as well. So
can I ask two questions? One is, what's your timeline for finishing this process?
I would like to finish it by the end of this week. We have had them now currently in the process for like a little while.
Forever.
So it's been a long process from the candidate standpoint, but at the same time, I don't want to rush it on our end. So we have, obviously tonight is a piece of it. I've started the references. There's a couple more people I'd like to talk to for both of them. So I'm anticipating Friday.
So let me ask one other question. And let me ask high level. So what are the two or three main attributes you're looking for this position versus hop mock, besides obviously different experience, right, elementary versus secondary? Push that aside. What are the key attributes you're looking for? And there's probably, sorry to put you on the spot.
That's but okay. So I think first off, we've talked a lot about accountability. I'm looking for somebody that has the ability to build a structure of accountability, not only with staff, but with students and with parents as well, kind of fostering all of those relationships and drawing backward accountability. The other piece that I think really resonates with me is student voice here at the high school. I think we've kind of gotten into a cycle where it's not valued as much as it has been in the past or could be in the future. And so I think getting student voice back into my high school is really important, which, I mean, I care what kindergartners at Hobmock say, but I don't know if it's really the administration at Hobmock. So I think student voice, accountability, and I'd also say I'm looking for somebody with creativity, somebody that's going to help us find the pathway for those kids that we don't already have an established pathway for.
Okay, so ultimately two and three tied is student engagement, student and staff engagement. Got it. Okay. Any other questions or comments?
No. You want our notes?
I'll give them if I can have it.
There's only seconds left.
Did you come by property?
Anything anybody else wants to add? No, we're still going on, so I just want to make sure. Thank you for participating. Thank you for listening. Thank you for participating in the process. We value it as well as the same as much as we valued all the people involved during the superintendent process, which was very long. We understand it's a little bit smaller and shorter, but we have the same value. We want to hear from people, so thank you very much. So we're moving on now to the library presentation.
We are. Thank you, Christine. Sorry.
I apologize. But we appreciate it. You staying around, and obviously, I'm sure you realize how important the first part was, and we didn't want to rush it. Now, I know you wanted to make this interactive and want us to move. What does that do to you?
Nothing.
You, get a good enough view over there? You want to move with us?
Sure.
Do you want to? Okay, so why don't we move over to the other part of the library, and we'll give, we'll also give Art a second if he needs to reorganize or...
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
I'm over too. New this year is the Lib Guide that I created. We just bought the latest version of the catalog through Fall at Destiny. We have about 33 databases that are free through Massachusetts Library System. They required that you had a full-time certified librarian, so we got those new this year. We do have a new collection of ebooks, also through MLS. And in the future, a possible rearrangement of the library by genre, which is something, it's a kind of a new big idea that people are going from the Dewey Decimal model over to a bookstore model in their libraries. This is the website for the LibGuide that you can type in as a URL, but I can get you there. The LibGuide links us to all of our print and digital resources. Students have direct access from school. Logging into a few of the resources from home requires a password, which I have in this pamphlet that I'll give to you before we leave, because a couple of them are paid for subscriptions. I already said this, free through the Mass Library System. They're reliable, high-quality resources, and most students know that they're the go-to for online research. And what we have found is that once I've begun introducing them first to grade 9 through their wellness classes, every grade 9 student learns how to get into the, it's called Gale, the company's Gale, into the Gale databases. They learned where they are, how to use them, how to cite them in MLA format. And then kind of as the year went on, I connected with English Language Arts, and especially with history, and especially with US history juniors who have a final, that's a paper in lieu of a written final. Students are being formally instructed in their use of the library and in class. The Destiny catalog, that catalog is where we search our print and some of our digital collection. It can be accessed through the LibGuide. It's completely web-based, and that's new. And one of the things that I realized when I got here was that, for example, our paperbacks are not electronically cataloged. And when I started to do it, I realized that we had a very isolated old system that couldn't talk to anything else. So if I typed in like Hatchet by Gary Paulson, a newer style catalog will connect to everything else, like the Library of Congress, and give me a picture of it. I click on it and it forms the record for it immediately. So we were really isolated, so that's why I really pushed for that upgrade, and we've got it. And it's going to be installed everywhere. I'm not sure if it's come over to you yet. It will be installed and there will be training. One of the things I also want to work towards, setting up individual accounts for students to enhance their searches. So when they use our new Destiny catalog, that they have, for example, they'll get all our print resources, all our ebooks, and Eric Digest, and our Gale databases in one search. So that's what I'm working towards. Ebooks, many schools and public libraries buy copies of ebooks. They are exorbitantly expensive. Some of them, they are not usable by everybody at the same time. It's one book, one student. Sometimes they actually expire. They disappear virtually after 2 years, and the book was $45. So collaboratively with the Mass Library System, we pitched in a little money. Pembroke Public Library pitched in some money, so we share them. They can be downloaded. And that's something that I've reached out to a lot of the teachers. I said, if you can carve out a little time before the kids go home, I can teach them how to read a book on their iPhone, or their iPad, or their Kindle Fire, or their Nook, and things like that. And they can find those on the LibGuide. So this is just my final word. In a perfect world, the best case scenario for any school district is a certified librarian at every school. A one-to-one initiative should be something we're talking about, but I've already heard that we can't afford it in the other part of the meeting. But I think that something close to it, maybe Chrome carts, maybe more carts, maybe a cart of computers per department, we can get really jammed in here. We can get to a point where every single solitary computer is in use. And then we have more kids coming in to ask to use them.
really heavy in technology. The kids are using technology for everything. They're submitting things through Turnitin, they're using Edmodo. A switch to Google would allow for blended learning, flipped classrooms, and paperless classrooms. A lot of the schools are using Google. It's free. It's education-based. We can set up Google Classrooms. That's something I could teach the teachers to do. More professional development for paraprofessionals, and a library scope and sequence for Pembroke K-12. And that's something I sent, I think, to Erin in a link where Warwick Public Schools got together and looked at what students should know from their experience in their libraries from K-12. So things like a book is read from left to right, how to look at the cover, how to find out who the author is, what an illustrator is. And, you know, that's like a Common Core state standard or an American Association of School Libraries standard when you're done with kindergarten, and then it moves on to first grade. So I think something like that would probably be really useful. We can look forward to a large group training on the Destiny catalog in the fall. Instructions for all students to sign up for a library card through Boston Public Library. And I know I was made aware that Pembroke Public Library will be here during lunch on Friday to sign the students up. But Boston Public, you can do, if you're over 13, you can go online and sign yourself up. You have access to all of their resources. And then a growing number of ebooks added to the shared collection as they become more popular. What I understand from the Mass Library System is that by the time the student puts a book on hold for the third time, it automatically purchases another copy. So they keep adding to the collection, yep.
I didn't know that.
I'm going to do that for the books I want. and you can. So this is what's my lib guide. This is called a lib guide. There's actually, I think, 450,000 of these. There's a community of lib guides. A lot of colleges, they're academically driven. A lot of colleges, universities, public schools create them. And it's sort of like a virtual file cabinet. So what I did was I put together a lib guide to include everything the students will need. So, for example, they can search the Pembroke High School Library from this link, the Pembroke Public Library. I posted our summer reading list, our hours, their ability to email me with questions. This is the home page, but if you go right here, the PHS database is all subjects. These are the databases offered that I mentioned through Mass Library System. They're being used very, very heavily by the students now. We've stopped Google as the go-to and Wikipedia as the go-to. These are peer-reviewed, high-quality, scholarly articles. ABC Clio is a little bit separate. Pembroke has had that for a long time. That's password protected. And there's one other one password protected called Science Online. But these cover every subject. Humanities right now is using the most heavily probably history. But there's books and authors, there's business, nursing, there's opposing viewpoints, it's like a debate site, there's gardening, just general reference and things like that. So if a student clicks into it, they can do searches, they can find what they need. Once they find articles, they can save it, they can highlight it, they can scroll to the bottom and copy and paste the citation MLA formatted to create a works cited page. So that's new this year, and they're using them a lot. Through my LibGuide, if I log in as an administrator, I can get the statistics on the number of times people have clicked on these blue tabs. So the PHS database is all subjects is way up over, I think it's in like 2,000. So I know the kids are heavily accessing that. If I go back here this is the high school library catalog. So Pembroke High School, and here it is right here. So here's just a simple search, catalog search. And that universal search key, that's going to be one that I'm going to work at setting up and with the help of the IT department, because students can do that search I talked about where it will go out to our databases. Some of them come free to us. Eric Digest is free. There's several other that are free, But we have to do something really technical with IP verification to get into our Gale databases and things like ABC Clio, because we can't have somebody stumble on them and just be using them for free. So we have to do what's called IP verification for that. So that's something that I'm going to work towards getting done for the students. So if you want to ask me questions, I can answer.
Could you highly go back to your main page again?
The LibGuide?
Yes, please.
Do you have to log in to get to that LibGuide?
You can get to it through the, if you go to Pembroke School's Pembroke High School, and you click on PHS Library, it opens now directly to the LibGuide. Mm-hmm. And then if you scroll down, here's the catalogs for public school, high school, and then these are the clickable links. There's all our databases. I made a list also of things like government sites, like the National Institute of Health, World Health, Mass.gov, USA.gov. We have e-editions of newspapers, Boston Globe, New York Times. I made a reference section, Britannica School, Google Maps, Mayo Clinic. Primary sources, I made this a lot for the history department. This is teaching with primary sources. This is, you know, things like Library of Congress, photographs, journal entries, and things like that. History, they have a research paper toolkit that's huge. So I made a link and we put it in here in a PDF. And then the history department, I've done a lot with them, and I started making these boxes for them. So things like the genocide class, United Nations, Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch. Math has a little bit. Wolfram Alpha, they can type in absolutely anything. English Language Arts. 21st Century Teaching Resources. Educational Origami by a New England educator. He's got this great digital Bloom's Taxonomy for teachers to use. So there's tons and tons of information here. And this is actually the Commonwealth eBook collection. And what that takes you to, we have three products from Commonwealth eBooks. I would highly recommend Access 360 as the top product. They have tons of great fiction. I've already gone through and spoke to the English Language Arts Department about the number of books on the summer reading list that are also available virtually, so the kids could download it. And the great thing about those books is that rather than a kid take out the one book and keep it all summer, they return themselves virtually in 21 days. So even if you forget, the book goes back, and you can hold it. You can create your own account, and you get a little button that says My Stuff. So those are the three products. Access 360, as I said, is probably will be the most popular. And that link takes you to all the ways that you download to your own device. So for example, this desktop, laptop, Android, Kindle Fire, Nook, and iPad, iPhone. So the directions are there for you to follow. I've already got it on my phone, and I'm like, you know, I mean, I got these glasses and everything. So reading on my phone isn't really, but it's so user-friendly, and the interface is nice, it's sharp, the pages turn beautifully. So I actually have been reading on my phone, and I know kids will absolutely do that. They'll absolutely do that. So, okay, now I'll stop. So now you can ask me questions.
So I have two questions. One, what do you mean by switch to Google?
Well, I'm finding myself that I just am not feeling that, first of all, that there's been a lot of buy-in with the kids for Office 365. User-friendly as Google. Google is completely cloud-based. Office 365 has kind of like an Earth copy and a cloud copy, and you kind of have to sync them together. I really made a concerted effort this year to get classrooms set up with Office 365. And I just don't find it as educationally friendly as Google.
Okay.
And Google's free.
Would that be part of the
technology? Yes. And my second question is, you said you're maxed out with the machines here. Can the students bring the devices that they have, like the ones you listed there, and do some of this stuff?
They do.
Or not?
Some of the kids do, but actually not many of the students do. And I found we did encounter some problems this year with MacBooks. because they would come in, they'd create something in Pages, then they would try to print, and it couldn't recognize our printer, and it would, we'd have to convert it to Word. So a lot of it has to do, I think, with compatibility issues and everybody kind of being on the same page. So my presentation is Google Slides. I came from a Google school and I had some Google training. They had, you know, one-to-one Chromebooks. I'm not completely sold on Chromebooks per se. I'm not really sure what their life is. I'm not sure if they're the sturdiest thing.
Good. Yeah, no, they have a great life.
Yeah, do they?
Yeah, they actually do.
Well, so
Google,
we had Chromebooks.
Google will eliminate a product without much warning, and all of a sudden stop supporting it.
Yeah.
We've done that for a lot of things.
I know a lot of people are using iPad, but, I mean, we wouldn't necessarily, you don't have to have a Chromebook to be a Google school. I mean, you can have something else, but you could Google, I mean, you just go on, you know, anywhere you sit down and you log back in. We have a lot of flash drive issues, a lot of, like I said, things created in Pages. Things saved as a PDF, things saved in the H drive, things getting dug out of the L drive, things being...
Are these all things that are being part of it?
Yes, sir. These are all things that come up through this survey piece that then they will chase down and figure out what the best course of action for us is.
Any other questions? Can you talk about what times of day the library is used or how it's used?
Typically, the kids are pulling on the door by 7:20, and they are absolutely here till 3:00 every day. So,
who's coming in during the day? Is it organized classes? Is it people that are in study halls? Is it during lunch? Or
it's all day straight through. Typically, both labs are booked by teachers with their classes, and then we get kids from directed study hall. We get about 25 or so. 27 kids from directive study.
How about the meeting rooms here? Are those used by the students, or?
They're used more by the faculty. A lot of one-on-one MCAS testing goes on in the conference room. Some whole class instruction time gets split up between kids who are using books and doing writing, and other kids have the computer. This gets pretty good use. There's probably like IEP meetings, guidance uses that room a lot.
So one of the things I think that I wanted to talk about tonight was the actual use of the library area in terms of how it could be better utilized by students in terms of, I mean, we have a lot of real estate here taken up by bookshelves. And if I look at the number of books that are checked out, we're averaging about 100 per month, what it ends up being.
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed a lot of libraries have gone to collaborative stations, reading areas, you know, nice comfortable chairs for reading, like even pseudo walls where they can have collaborative meetings and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
What's the thought on that? How do we move the library?
Well, I think I know there's a big move now towards more of a learning commons style.
Yeah.
And I do think that there's probably a great deal of nonfiction that's probably aged out. A lot of information can be found online.
It looks like you have great resources.
So, I mean, part of a weeding and making more space that's different than bookshelves could be taking away a lot of the nonfiction, because we know that we can find the information online. You know, sets of encyclopedias and things like that, they're just not accessed. And there's things like, you know, they're before the space station, Pluto's still a planet, things like AIDS and cancer, Ebola, that's way behind in 2001 encyclopedias. So there's that aspect of it. And I mean, another thing I mentioned earlier was they're calling it the genrefication of libraries, and that's creating more like a bookstore
right.
model that's more comfortable, more attractive to students, more ease of use. Because students now will still come in and say, where's your adventure books, or where's your fantasy books? And from my research, I know librarians are experiencing like triple the circulation. And people are doing things like just getting little color-coded dots and making pink, you know, fantasy books, and they all go on the same shelf in alphabetical order and things like that. Some people even go as far as to take their nonfiction into that collection. I don't know. I'm ready for that.
Some of the other things I've seen libraries do are, you know, like So the reading, I mean, I was told we can't do coffee.
No, we get some coffee in the school system. Thank you, guys.
But you could, I mean, but if you make it that people can bring in lunch or whatever and meet with their teams or collaboration, and even painting some of the walls with the whiteboard paint and stuff like that, a lot of places have also gone to what's called makerspaces.
Oh, yeah.
With, you know, I think we have a lot of equipment that's probably underutilized, but 3D printer, that, you know, we talk about the engagement and getting kids opportunities.
Right.
The other area would be, you know, I would have the time of day that we're open, you know, whether, you know, we're after school more, where kids are hanging out more, and they're more apt to collaborate on topics if they've got group projects. I just don't know if kids have a place really to go to work and to do tutoring or things like that.
So, kind of building on that idea, I think I have a couple other questions afterwards. Could you turn it into some type of more attractive word than like a reading club or a library club where kids come and hang out? Maybe you can't sell coffee, but you could have it, keeping it away from the technology, have something where the students can come, congregate, a book club or something, just where they could come in, you know, enjoy the library for it, make it like a mini Barnes & Noble, right? Mm-hmm. That's the experience you're talking about. You know, taking all the good reading chairs out of Barnes & Noble. You know what I mean. But that's what you're trying to get to, isn't it? And would it make the library more attractive? Because
yeah, I mean, where they can feel comfortable, you know, then use do the research projects or whatever.
They come in.
There's nothing holding a kid back from the library. Yeah. In fact, it's probably the most popular place to go in the building if you're not, you know, if you have a study or if you have free time. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a resource issue in terms of students being supervised or unsupervised and who is going to be managing that after a certain time of the day. So there's some, you know, some of that needs to be thought through, but I would say students would use the library into the evening hours if we were able to keep it open, and they love being here. That's not.
I think it's a pure conversation about the space. So if you look at the space we're sitting in right now, if 95% of this is used for a lab, for a classroom, you know, having a cart and using this space for something more beneficial for kids, whether it's a maker lab or a space.
Or do we need more spaces like this instead of, you know, the nonfiction books that are outdated? Mm-hmm. I mean, which leads me to another part of, with the town library, you can reserve books and they come in. Then any talk about maybe getting somebody to pick those books up and get them over here for kids, that they could use the resources available, and therefore especially the nonfiction stuff, they just go online and reserve them, they get pulled off the shelf, you know, shipped over here on a every other day basis or whatever.
Well, if they had their own account for Pembroke Public Schools, they could reserve a book here too. They could hold it, and it would, we could do that.
Would it come out of the library system?
These books here.
The nice thing though about the public library is
or like an interlibary loan situation.
Yeah, it's got the whole South Shore, so I pretty much, I use that most of the time.
Right.
Every book I ever really wanted.
Yeah, I've used it. Yeah.
So yeah. I guess because one of the things, you know, I heard is trying to marry the K-12 library system, which makes a lot of sense, because I think one of the things I'd like to see is us have kids want to read for pleasure. It seems, again, at least my experience with my kids, and I think it's probably the majority of children, is every time they're asked to read, it's a chore, and they don't understand, but they don't go and search out books that are of interest and want to read a book. And maybe it's I don't know, maybe it's just a cultural thing, or an age thing, a generational thing. But I think we want to make the children turn into, you know, lifelong readers, right, and understand how to look. And to me, you need to do it by tying K-12, but the other thing to me, you know, I heard it's great trying to have the library here to sign kids up for library cards. I think that's the first step. But how do we integrate with the Pembroke Public Library? Because you're not just getting all the books within that building. The whole sales network, you can get just about anything in print, mm-hmm. right? And to Paul's point, if they reserve it, is there a way to tag it so that it could come here and they could have books come and, you know, check in and check out through here as an extension of the library? How can we integrate so that they can drive their circulation through allowing us to also get those books in front of the kids?
I mean, we could figure out a way to do interlibrary loan. I mean, there, it's, again, it's more like the human resources of it. I mean, in Rhode Island, they have a network, and they actually have drivers that drive books from Coventry to Bristol to Warwick to...
I was thinking we're doing that because, we're doing that because it goes from town to town.
It goes from town to town.
What if this became a branch
of the Pembroke Public Library? And again, we're talking a little bit, and we understand you don't have all these answers, but it's just that it's what conceptual could we tie into the public library? Because again, that's another town investment, and how do we take advantage of that and the town maximizes the return on that investment, right? And then how does that allow us to use this space better? Because maybe that's less hard copies we have to have here that allows you to now get to collaborative space. And that's, I think, where I know that's at least what I'm thinking. You know, I like the, for lack of a better term, Barnes & Noble concept of going in, you know, looking at a book, oh yeah, you know what, I think I'd like to read this or buy this, or if I don't want to buy it, then at least I have the name written down so I can go to the Pembroke Public Library and reserve.
Poor Dewey.
What's that?
Poor Dewey.
Yeah, exactly. But I do think, by the way, I agree with that. That's, I don't know the Dewey Decimal System, don't want to know the Dewey Decimal System, but I know I can find a book real quick from Barnes & Noble, a little bit quick because of the way they have them labeled in the Pembroke Public Library, right? I know where all the biographies are just because I take out a lot of biographies, but how do we make that experience more kid-friendly, what they're used to?
Well, I can. We had 6,000 kids come through here in May.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sure.
So, you know, the library is being utilized. I mean, it absolutely is. Every seat, every computer, many books. I mean, as far as linking to the Pembroke Public Library, I know that districts link to other schools. But I don't know about the public library. I know that when we had our interlibrary loan, I know Massachusetts library system has an interlibrary loan system that you can connect to and become part of it. And it involves, you know, hold, and every morning you come in and there's books on hold and you wrap them up and they get shipped. And
I think it's just worth a conversation because at least my experience with our librarian, Deb Wall, has been very positive. I think she's a supporter of the schools. She does a great job with that library. She's very passionate about it, and she's passionate about this community. It's worth a discussion to see how she would think she could plug in, because I think it's a win-win, right? I think it gets more people walking through her door that aren't doing it today, but it also helps us by exposing our children to an opportunity that they have today, but they might not know about.
I think it's also important to recognize that Christina's coming in after a couple years of not having a librarian,
sure.
So I think she's done an amazing job kind of getting the library back up to speed for the use. But I think as a district and as a committee, the future of the libraries, I think, has been a future agenda item for the past almost 2 years. And it's just one of those things that we don't put a lot of effort into, because then we get into a budget cycle where we're not putting any resource into it. And, you know, we talk about cutting library pairs at the elementary level and changing the model at the middle school. I definitely think it's a conversation that there's a lot of good points to, and that we should definitely have. But I do just want to recognize the amount of work Christina's done this year.
Love that. It's all the different databases and stuff.
I would also say the training in the classrooms for teachers has been, like, exceptional, and the organization, being able to book your labs online, being able to book space online, all kinds of things that are just the way of the world now. So
we're trying to be absolutely supportive and trying to expand how we use this space. We look at this very valuable, and I know you know, we all enjoy reading for pleasure, so it's something we're passionate about. We want to see it used. The other thing I would say is, when we have all of the presentations with all the departments, mm-hmm. next year let's add the libraries to it. It's worth it. It's because you talked about.
I feel like it can fit in with guidance, kind of as like just
wherever it fits. I think it's worthwhile, because then we'll see what the value is, mm-hmm. right? And it probably would eliminate a lot of discussions about, okay, if we have a cut to make, you know, what we're going to cut the powers, or we'll not have a librarian because we didn't have one, you know, it'll eliminate that even from the dialogue. Not that I think anybody ever got serious about it, but I think it's something that
then we can start to add it to the level one, level two priorities and have the discussion of, okay, we want to do X, Y, we want to invest $2,000, I'm just going to throw out a number, to buy more comfortable chairs for what Paul says, or to reconfigure the space, right, to make the whiteboards on walls for kids to...
No, and I think this summer provides us an opportunity to make the library a little bit different, so when kids come back in the fall, they notice that we're kind of adapting towards what their needs are, so it's not a full 180 of what the library is now, but at least it's steps towards, you know, addressing the needs.
In an essence of time.
What? Is there a time?
Thank you. Sorry.
We still got a lot of stuff, Mr. Chair.
I just want to make sure we...
It was great. I mean, just the consolidation of what's been done so far is amazing.
Yeah, it looks good. Amazing. You said you had a pamphlet for us? Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Policy.
We'll come and visit us, I think.
First read of the policy?
Well, we have a dialogue, too.
We wait for the superintendent.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, so we are now moving into the superintendent's report, consideration of acknowledgement of a gift from Harvard Pilgrim to the PHS band.
Correct, so two of the parents of band students work for Harvard Pilgrim and they have the matching. If you give time, we'll give you money. I don't know what that is officially called. So there's two $500 matching donations from Harvard Pilgrim to the Pembroke High School band.
That's awesome. So is there a motion to acknowledge the gift from Harvard Pilgrim of $1,000 to the PHS band?
So moved and with thanks.
Second. Motion by Jenny, second by Paul. We send just a note of thanks to the parents for donating their time and for putting in for this. And it, obviously this money is greatly appreciated. So, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain?
Okay.
Unanimous.
Okay. Can I ask a policy question? I guess?
Yes.
Policy. We look at the gift policy because we seem to be getting a lot of direct gifts, which is not allowed. You know, technically not allowed. But
policy.
Maybe we should figure out how we allow for that.
Yeah, I think directed gifts are a good thing. The reason why we didn't is we didn't want. You know, we wanted to create some type of equity across the district. So,
but I think we should. Is there a way in the policy to address that or whatever?
Fair enough. Because we don't want to turn away free money. Is Paul's point? I think we agree. So,
answer to your question is yes, Paul.
And it also, it then becomes kind of selective on us if we say one we accept and one we don't. We don't have a policy for directive gifts.
Fair enough.
Put that on.
So we had some. Committee reorganization, and with Patrick not here tonight, let's put this on hold until our next meeting. We have the subcommittees that are moving anyway, mainly negotiations. What I would like to say is you have the list of historical members. If there are items, if there are subcommittees that you prefer, please, if there are subcommittees that you prefer over others, please let me know and we shall try to adjust accordingly at our next meeting.
So you're looking at, so we don't say status quo, we just say what we're interested in?
Yeah, I think so, because the last year when we had them, we had a lot of discussion because a couple of them had more people interested than spots.
But you highlighted negotiations. But
negotiations, right, because we're in the middle of negotiations, we probably don't want to change.
We're also in the middle of doing some policy stuff, too. That's all I
understood.
Okay.
A little, right, that's probably a little bit easier to change if people wanted to change. If somebody wanted to come off or somebody really wanted to come on, we could have that discussion. But I'm just trying to understand what...
We want to change.
Absolutely.
Do you have the input on who she wants
to do? So that's different.
Or not,
speak up if you want to change.
I don't think I have that.
It's different than clean slate. That's what I'm trying to get.
Okay, what everyone thinks.
That's what I'm trying to figure out.
Speak up if you want to change this.
Correct.
Or
she's saying wipe the slate.
Clean slate.
Well, what are people's gut feelings? Does everybody want to stay the way it is?
Let's wait for Patrick to have the discussion. But if somebody has a burning desire to
change what's here, talk to them.
Gotcha, okay, that's different than what I thought I heard, so I just wanna make sure.
See, this is what happens when it's like.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll put that on for the next meeting. And policy, consideration of first read of LDCA policy and procedure for approval of a private school. And this came out of a request from the community.
Do that one?
So a little background on this, Erin, would you like to provide?
Sure, so two separate actual items, right? So we don't currently have a policy for the approval of a private school, which is something the policy subcommittee is going to try to work through. In addition to that, we were approached by a parent group that is currently, it's a part of a homeschooling network in Pembroke, and it's housed at the Trellis Learning Academy, which is right over by where the BBC is in Pembroke. The Trellis Learning Academy has acted as a place for homeschool families to come together and work in small groups and have some extension activities for kids. That is disbanding. So some of the parents from that group are looking to open in the same space a private school. That actually educates children K through 8. Originally I thought it was K through 12, but it's K through 8. The first step when that group was attempting to get a lease on the property was that private schools require school committee approval within the district that they are found. And if I will send to you guys electronically, there is DESE guidance. Because Massachusetts General Law Chapter 76, Section 1 says that a private school must be approved to open in the town, but that's all the guidance. They give you a sample list of criteria that you could use in your approving of a school, but there's a lot of kind of conversation between should, suggest, connoting, that type of stuff.
Either way, we still have to make sure we're allowing something that is above board, that standard, whatever
right.
you want to call it, we have to make sure that it is delivering the intended.
That's how we would practice this group of people as we know each other individuals. So the law suggests does not demand.
Right.
So the language that you have. As a first read, is our suggestion.
Yes.
I mean, what's the definition of a private school?
Yeah. And we have a lot of questions that we
versus
directed.
Versus group of homeschooling. I mean, that's the thing.
Right.
That would be my first question, is why would we have to approve a group of homeschooling?
So they're looking to be a private school,
a
501c3, you know, full learning day for students in a location. Obviously, they don't have to meet the 900 or 990 hours, but they do have depending on the criteria that you set to demonstrate some sort of what a school day looks for the students, what the curriculum looks like in relation to what we're offering.
Do they have to do it every year, like a homeschooling?
There's no guidance on
what about funding? They know like Title I, and so we have private schools in town. There's like pieces of our Title I grant that we have to allow them to use.
And they're not looking to be a charter school either.
No.
Yeah.
So they're looking to be a private school similar to whether you want to call it a Montessori or
like
a Catholic or whatever it happens.
Well, not Catholic, that would be different.
Well,
parochial would be different. Covered by a different body.
Districts done, or what do we have for examples?
So I would say there's policy still looked at a handful of samples. There's kind of two philosophies in how to tackle it. There's the, you know, here's some criteria, here's a checklist, here's our procedures, and then there's what we've put in front of you, I think, as a suggestion that's kind of just a blanket policy that says in order to open a private school in Pembroke, school committee needs to feel that the education that's being delivered is equivalent to what is delivered in the public school.
The problem is, so we do have a suggested list of guidelines, and the state charges the school committee to approve. But our question is, risk in terms of, you know, who are we to evaluate? What are the tools that would measure success? And so, as Erin said, we can pass to you for your information, but suffice to say that what we've been looking at in these five or six other policies, all of the school systems that try to list out samples and suggestions, we could poke holes at and say, oh, but you didn't ask for this, oh, but you didn't ask for that. So the reason that we're passing to you this policy is it's taken directly from is this document?
This is the DESE guidance.
Right.
So it's take this language is simplified and we think clarified. Basically, the message is a private school can come petition the Pembroke Public Schools, and we would have to decide if it's equivalent in these three ways to our existing Pembroke Public Schools in order for us to approve it.
Right, but looking at this.
I'm reading the paragraph after that line.
I'm looking at it, which is important, I think is important to me, is once a school is approved, the approval is subject to renewal or periodic review. And it says, although not required by statute, school committees are encouraged to adopt a private school approval policy that incorporates a periodic review of previously approved schools. So,
it says here, school committee approval is either an evaluation of program quality or an endorsement of any particular school.
But yeah, they mandate you have to approve it.
So my question is, why are school committees charged with doing this?
Right.
Well, the way I read it,
the state watches over charter schools.
It's so that they're not in violation of attendance laws. That we're recognizing that private schools.
So we have to recognize it so that under the compulsory attendance law, that a student between 6 and 16 is in attendance of a school. So it has to be recognized.
So I see as our fundamental thought process is, are we going to approve something and spend a lot of time, you know, doing the checklist and making sure everything's all okay and doing that periodically? That's a lot of time and energy and money and staff and personnel.
Utilization of our superintendent.
And we have to think thoughtfully about, right, whether we're going to do that. On the flip side, we have, you know, do we, it's a tough call, because actually after a school committee approves it, nobody monitors them.
So
Desi doesn't even do it.
They don't monitor it, but we could set the approval process. But in
the
sample,
no appeal process is the fact that if we denied it, they can't appeal it anymore.
Right.
So can I ask it?
It's an odd law.
Well, as most of them are.
But you wouldn't want to arbitrarily dismiss, you know, or reject somebody's application. Can I ask a question? Because
as opposed, you don't want to arbitrarily approve something too.
Understood.
So it's,
and they give the 11 criteria. So that we can move this forward, because it's not just going to be the policy. I look at two other potential things we have to look at. Number one, this memorandum from DESE is 9 years old. It's from 2007. Can we ask them for guidance on what other districts have done or anything like that, or they can tell us what other districts have approved new schools?
That's where we started from.
But have there been no schools approved in the last couple of years in any of the towns around us? Or?
There are.
And what's, do we have a list of their criteria? Or
we have, yes,
very
expensive. Their policies.
It's what?
We very expensive.
Okay, so can we look at that?
A lot of time and energy.
Can we also, and I'm thinking this is more of a Hesse, Toomey, and Lehane question.
Yes.
Can we ask them to,
yes,
first of all, frame an opinion?
Yes.
How many people think
we,
on one?
We also want a petition to state.
Ginny didn't finish what our policy committee said, is that we were going to direct the superintendent to do just as you are saying.
Okay, so what are we going to direct the superintendent? Let me see if there's more.
Yeah, that's
so
okay.
we're not accepting any policy tonight or anything.
We wanted to bring forward our best suggestion for now, knowing that, and telling you that we have seen six other school systems and their language, and we were able to poke holes in all of their guidelines.
So you're just updating us on status of your process at this point and not asking us to make any decisions.
Correct.
So based upon that, can we provide those six districts that I teach in Lehane and ask them if they could tell us what they think would be a best practice on a policy or what they've seen from other districts, just so we have some type of guidance? And can we also, somebody draft what we want Patrick to take to Josh, Representative Cutler, Senator DiMacedo on petitioning the state to change this? Because their policy is antiquated, or their guidance is antiquated.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a real life situation that we need to, we have a fiduciary responsibility towards the students that are gonna be serviced by this institution.
And they're not necessarily even Pembroke students. They could be from anywhere.
There could be no Pembroke students. However, they're in our town, and by the way the law is written, we have some responsibility over them.
Yeah, are we liable if somebody says in 5 years they didn't learn anything?
Absolutely.
Right.
And they go back to public school and have to go back.
Absolutely.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yes. I'm trying to understand the purposefulness of the law. Mm-hmm. That's because if I understood the purposefulness of the law, then I might understand what it's trying to do.
Looking at this in a couple of minutes, based upon a couple of the answers and then their criteria, what they're doing is they are deferring the review of an educational institution
exactly.
to the local body.
You are right.
Rather than taking it on themselves, because I'm sure they're looking at this would be too much effort for DESE to take and take every private school under their wing. Because if this school is just there and has 20 students, and I think if there was a school in Hanover similar, if they open up and they only have a certain amount of students, they don't want to have to deal with outside of the 251 cities and towns, they don't want to have to deal with another 800, you know, making a wild guess on how many of there are of these institutions. Okay.
And the review of a school with two students as opposed to the review of a school with 102 students is the same.
Has to be
it's the same.
Got it.
So,
okay. So for this,
we'll bring that.
Can we put this on the agenda for the next meeting because we need an update?
Yeah.
And so,
do you think we'll have one for
them? Yes.
Yeah.
We'll have.
We're trying.
We need to keep this as an ongoing agenda item until it's resolved.
Okay.
So I'll take a motion to accept for first read.
I don't think we should. Do we want to take it for first read? There is no policy put in front of us. Is there?
Yeah, there is.
Still
waiting.
There is. That's what you guys are recommending?
As a first read, something.
Yeah.
I don't feel comfortable.
Once it's a first read, then you have 6 to 8 weeks and you can discuss it.
We want to be able to
discuss it. I want to be able to discuss it.
That's why we're bringing it to get.
But also what the difference is between you updating us on your process.
Because then we would have to take even longer to go through.
So if we don't accept the first read, we can't have a discussion on it. And if we don't have a discussion on it, if we choose to change it or not adopt it for a final read, we can't do that.
And if you don't do anything now, you need at least two more meetings, even if we rescind it.
And we do.
We do
have a public request to reply in a timely manner because they're talking about school starting for them if they go forward.
And we want to be able to do it on the terms in which we feel.
Absolutely.
Right.
That doesn't mean we should be rushing our agendas and forcing things through.
We're not. We think that this is our timeline, and that's why we're bringing it to you now. We think that we will have some kind of an update. And we're not saying that the second read will be next week.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So, again, is there a motion? Because otherwise we'll have to move on. Is there a motion to accept for a first read policy, LBCA, policy and procedure for the approval of a private school?
Second.
So motion by Ginny, second by Suzanne. Is there further discussion?
I don't think we have enough information or confidence in this.
Exactly right.
To accept it as a first read, even.
Oh, okay. I disagree.
Okay.
The language that we've given you is a starting place. We fully expect that it could change.
Yeah, but the problem that I see is that if it changes, then we still have to go, we'll have a discussion go back and forth where the next time it comes is really for the final revision of how it should be, and that's what we're voting on. So it's typically what we've done is got a very good first draft, and the tweaks are a couple worrying, maybe something here or there, not a complete rewrite of the whole policy.
It is unusual
that
we would have extensive changes, but we feel that this could go on for several meetings and several iterations. And it's just a matter of starting the conversation now and getting it planted.
I just don't like being put on the clock when we don't have enough information. We just have a hard time.
There's no deadline. We don't have to ever get through this for the next 5 years if we don't want to.
But we have to vote on the second read.
No, we just don't approve it.
We don't have to move it.
Somebody could argue that the first read becomes, if your policy is that you have to do it, it's on argument that the second read is automatic.
But then we can have at the next meeting after that, we can vote to rescind the policy.
Yep.
Correct.
We don't want to go.
I think that this is a very entwined particular policy that might involve a conversation, you know, a lot of behind the scenes, you know, not behind the scenes, but a lot of policy sub-conversation, but then additional school committee conversation,
so reading,
unlike other policies.
Reading what's been drafted, in accordance with state law, the Pembroke School Committee will approve a public school when it is satisfied that the instructional program of the school equals that of the town's public schools in thoroughness, efficiency, and progress made. Therefore, we're at least putting parameters that it has to be to our standard before we'll approve.
Correct.
So without this, we lack policy of anything. We would be looking at each on an individual case-by-case basis.
So what's thoroughness, efficiency, and progress mean?
Exactly.
So I mean, but we have it's too vague to me to approve a policy if it's not vague. But I think we're opening ourselves up for a huge liability that if somebody puts in front of you one piece of paper,
we're not
going to vote.
This will go nowhere.
So
if we don't take the appropriate action.
So let me ask the question a different way. If we're presented with the plan for them to open the school, we have to take it as an agenda item, correct?
No, you have to have a policy first for approval of a private school.
Okay,
we're on the clock if you're excited.
But if we don't have a policy, then we're going to be forced into doing a policy quickly in order to get this to approve the school if that's the predecessor. So either we create our own policy on our own timeline, which we're trying to do here, or we don't create anything and then we have to do it based upon their timeline.
We feel that we are being respectful of the request from this entity by addressing it.
This is, I know it's the first time it's come here, but this isn't the first time that you've been looking at this. You've been looking at this for a little bit.
Yeah, it's been about a month that we've been kind of going back and forth.
Since right around April vacation time.
Right after April vacation.
Was when it was requested.
Okay.
Any further discussion? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Abstained? So it passes 3-1-0. I voted yes. Okay?
Thank you.
All right. So, start until December?
The other request I could probably tie into that as well is we talked as we went through the spring budget session and talked all about the social emotional. Could we get an overview of what social emotional means? Like a definition? We keep talking about social emotional needs. What, throw up five examples without mentioning names of here is somebody who is struggling because of this or.
When did
you
say that?
Just future. And I think it makes sense to pair that with what our supports are for that. So I think that's probably more of an early fall.
Can we do that? Does that separate from number 10, the bullying? Or should we do that in September? And then that'll tie into the bullying piece?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I just want to understand.
I think it's going to end up being kind of a catch-all word.
It does.
But I think what it'll do is it'll be a natural progression.
Yeah. I mean, I'd like to understand what are the challenges, what's a couple scenarios of what kids are like facing, their challenges.
Okay, so I'll take a motion at 9:54 to go into executive session pursuant to Chapter 38, Section 21A3 to discuss a personal services contract as an opening meeting may have detrimental effect on the legal position of the school committee as declared by the chair with no further business to occur afterwards.
So
motion by Paul. Motion by Suzanne then. Second by Paul. Ginny. Suzanne?
Yes.
Paul?
Yes.
And I vote yes. So roll call is unanimous.
Good night, everyone.
Thank you.
Good night.
Thanks, everyone.